the nominee, ladies and gentlemen. He is now officially the nominee. I'm going to be inside the convention center this evening and, of course, tomorrow. One of the big international news stories is the fact that some communists ran over to me and started pushing and shoving me on the sides, and one of them slapped me in the back of the head. I'm not even sure who. So I just went ahead and tried to push over a few of them and then ran into the police chief. That's basically what happened. But the police were there, and then the crowd started trying, part of the crowd, about half the folks there were InfoWarriors, started trying to attack the police. The police had to use bikes to basically, one cop that I saw a video of was holding back six of the communist protesters himself. And Gawker and others, just to illustrate, not that Gawker matters, you know, they're going under, according to reports of the whole Hulk Hogan thing. Gawker just loves to distort reality. And I was reading this piece this morning, and it said that it was classic that I'm this anti-government person, and here I am with the police helping me. And there I was battling real anarchists. No, people with red flags want total government. And I'm sick and tired of communists calling themselves anarchists, okay? Just because I don't want a big, giant government and I want lower taxes doesn't mean I hate the local police or I want to shoot them in the back of the head. That's the globalist run left that's destabilizing the nation, not us. So they're always trying to act like we're not genuine, we're not real. No, we're genuine Americana. You don't know what we stand for? Americana. Freedom, lower taxes, being left alone, being able to defend yourself, being able to practice the religion or not practice the religion of your choice, not having to go under Sharia law. That's who we are. We're called the Renaissance promoters. All right, ladies and gentlemen, there is so much coming up today that it makes my head spin. We have Ted Nugent coming on the broadcast. We have Roger Stone set to be in studio. We have a bunch of other special guests, but I was walking out of a business this morning buying another toothbrush as I lost my other one somehow and my travel toothbrush. And there, just about 45 minutes ago, was Tucker Carlson, who I had dinner with on Sunday evening, and some of the Daily Caller folks and a whole bunch of other press people. And he goes, "Oh, I'm glad you're coming." And I said, "Coming to what?" He goes, "Nigel Farage." And I said, "Whose event it is?" He goes, "It's mine, but no one's, you know." I said, "Well, is it going to be on Fox?" If Fox had half a brain, they'd have, you know, Nigel Farage on, you know, for a long talk. And he goes, no. And he goes, "No one's covering it, really." I said, "Really? Well, I just sent like three reporters or four reporters over there." And so we're going to get the Farage speech that I guess starts about now, and then that talk, and then hopefully an interview. We should have that maybe by the fourth hour today, because this, I mean, we just, well, the one problem we've got is we need more crew members. We don't have enough people to upload all the videos we've got. We've got so many big interviews, and a lot of them aren't time sensitive, but some of them are, that are going to be going out today. We're going to push these all out today. So I literally ran in here 2 minutes before they randomly search every eighth vehicle that comes into the containment zone, and the Secret Service searched our vehicle. I mean, they search them all for bombs with the bomb dog and the mirror underneath the car, but they search the inside of the car. And I don't want to get them in any trouble, but let's just say that, well, I'll just say at another checkpoint yesterday, Rob, dude, come tell folks what happened. We literally, Rob's running the switcher right now, news director, but he's also going to come tell you. I mean, we're talking Secret Service going, InfoWars, InfoWars.
Yeah, this happened this morning, actually, coming in.
Well, it happened 2 years ago.
Yeah, oh, yeah, they're definitely fans, and I've been talking with them. In fact, the security guard who lets us in at night, her name and her brother's a big fan. And she goes, "Oh, he was so excited to hear that we met you guys." And I took a selfie and sent it to her.
And again, this isn't us bragging, "Hey, we're famous." It's saying the InfoWars
people are waking up. Yeah. And then this morning, the Secret Service, when we pulled up, they recognized. They're like, "InfoWars, good job yesterday. Good job."
Yeah, it's crazy. Let's not get them in too much trouble. We'll be back. Well, we've got 2 days left of the convention. And then, of course, the Democratic National Convention coming up next week. What a giant police state circus we're in the middle of. But this is a police state built of our own folly. This is what Americans have allowed with the jihadis in this country, and the borders wide open, and with all the different leftist groups and the Soros-backed organizations running around stoking violence. This is what you end up having to have, or they'd be storming the RNC. They've stormed Trump events all over the country. They've attacked people. People have been killed. Police are getting killed on a daily basis now, almost. It is crazy. And Rob Due, a news director, is here with us. We have a gigantic broadcast today. We're talking about a few issues first off here, but tell folks who's coming up today.
All right. At 11:30, 12:30 Eastern, it'll be Diamond and Silk in studio. And then at the top of the hour at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock our time here in Cleveland, Roger Stone is going to be here. And then at the bottom of the hour, 12:30, 1:30 Eastern, Ted Nugent on the phone. And that should be pretty interesting because of what's going on here at the convention. And then after that, a 1 hour interview with Dinesh D'Souza, talking about his film, which I haven't seen it, but from what I hear from the other crew, they said it's one of the best films they've seen in a long time as a documentary.
Yeah. I mean, America 2015 or 2016 was kind of milquetoast and kind of, oh, he's anti-colonialist. Well, really globalism is corporate colonialism to take us over, but it does hint that he hates America. No, this new film is Hillary is a crime boss, a horrible witch. The Democrats are an organized crime syndicate, hell-bent on destroying the country, collapsing it, consolidating control, and putting us in re-education camps.
And
shocking to hear, but that's really what they're doing. Yeah. And boy, that happens in most other countries. Look at the crap going on in Turkey right now.
Well, and they're using the social media apparatus as the concentration camp now. That's like the virtual concentration camp now where they cut people off Twitter. They censor stories.
Yeah, look at Milo. Permanently banned with his tens of millions of people on Twitter.
Ridiculous.
I mean, because he's a flamboyant gay guy that says he's sick of social justice warriors and their attack on free speech. Well, I mean, they're a plague. They are a literal plague. And it is so frustrating just to see this getting worse and worse and worse. Now, really exciting news. On my way over here today, walking out of a store, there was Tucker Carlson with a bunch of people getting out of a sedan. And he said, "Hey, Alex, great. I'm glad you're here." And I said, "What?" Because I had dinner with him and a bunch of media Sunday night when we got in. Well, you were there. And I go, "Here for what?" He goes, "Farage." And I went, "Who?" He goes, "Nigel Farage." I go, "Oh, Nigel Farage." I go, "What? He's, you know." And I said, "Well, where's the media for this?" He goes, "Well, I'm just doing a little, you know, thing with the press, a breakfast." And I guess it's like a 11s or something that Hobbits have, because it's almost noon here when that happened. And so we just sent a bunch of reporters over there, very excited about that. I think Nigel Farage is like a rock star. See, I don't get woo about rock stars. I don't go woo about movie stars.
He's retiring in his prime, too. And I think hopefully we can talk him out of that.
Well, that's why we sent reporters over there to all just basically to talk to him and say, how could you be retiring in your prime? The thing is, he doesn't, you know, play hard to get or whatever like some politicians do when they say, "I'm not going to run for office and make everybody beg for him." The times I've talked to him off air, he's like, "Oh, man, I just want to beat this and get back to business in my life and, you know, back to, you know, drinking beer at the pub after work." I mean, he just does not like it. But that's why he's so effective.
Yeah.
And he just straight talks these scumbags, these arrogant people never had a job, you know, in their life. And, of course, they tried to kill him. And he's had the wheels come off his car. And the police said it was sabotage in the EU. They said, "No, you were sabotaged." And then the plane crashed. And I mean, the pilot's a vegetable. I mean, Farage climbs out of it, his whole face smashed, blood pouring out of his head. And had, like, many bones broken. I mean, it was incredible.
And he still has the courage to speak out. He didn't hide after that.
And well, the thing is, the truth is, and I don't blame him, you know, that's kind of something that one guest hinted at. You know, I'm sure the threats are getting to him. At a certain point, he's been leading that party since it started 22 years ago. He's sick of it. And I kind of get wanting to not do it anymore. Because you're either, like, totally and completely 100% committed. You're either totally committed to something, or you're disengaged. That's how I am. I can't quit thinking about fighting the globalist. I dream about it. I live it constantly. I'm hyperventilating on air thinking about it. Yesterday, here's
hyperventilating off the air.
Hyperventilating off the air. Yesterday, I knew that they were having this communist party. That's what officially was event, and I knew that they were going to have a flag burning, and I knew that they were having Black Lives Matter out there, and I knew they had this Dix guy who is, like, always there a few days before horrible stuff happens.
Stoking the flames.
And so when I got there and they were screaming at us and surrounding us and trying to bully us, even though about a third or more of the folks were InfoWarriors, they were all just nicely standing there. All the socialists were bullying and clawing and, you know, bumping into me underneath, you know, the cameras. I said, "I got to get up there on that high spot and get away from these people. So I start trying to go up, and they're pushing us, and they're hitting us, and they're pushing our crew, and they're pushing on my bodyguards who were there to watch my back and document things.
Yep.
And they were having a and you can now, we're kind of go through the videos, we have just so many, where they were already having to grab people who were trying to hit me. And of course, these are vegan, I'm not bashing vegans, but, you know, vegan leftists are not usually pretty tough. It was mainly white kids, white college folks attacking me. And so that was already going on. I was already putting up with getting shoved and stuff. And then suddenly there's red flags around me, racist, Nazi, racist, I'm like scrabbling. And I'm being, you can see on the video, before I decided to go ahead and push over them, I'm being pushed and poked from both sides. But I mean, pretty violently. I'm moving back and forth. And I just say, that's it. I'm going to the top of the steps. So I start pushing through them. They get pushed out of the way, but I keep pushing. And then there's the police chief who I obviously could see I wasn't looking when I run into him.
Right.
He grabs my arm. I tell, oh, actually, someone with force has actually grabbed me. I'm like, oh, I go, oh, who's that? Oh, it's the police chief.
That's a very iconic moment in that whole
You're like, oh, the crowd is the police chief, which I guess everybody thought was hilarious, especially the police. And then the
bike cops move in and start separating the people. And our guys, me, Josh, and Zimmerman, that's how we got separated from y'all. We were getting pushed back by the guys on the bikes. I said, hey, relax. We're good.
That is kind of a commie hat, though.
Yeah, I'd probably look like a
commie. But it helps you blend in.
Yeah, and I actually got an interview with the communists later that afternoon. And I went up and I go, hey, aren't you the guys that attacked Alex Jones? I think I called them commies. Aren't you the commies that attacked Alex Jones? They're like, we didn't attack him. And then in the video, we cut to him pushing you, and then you push back, you know, because you can only take so much. And that's the type. It's not even this. The stuff that's going on in this convention is sort of a backdrop for what's really going on in America.
Well, exactly. I mean, I'm sitting there in the heat, surrounded by these people hissing at me, and I look at red flags up above me on the steps like they've taken the country.
They're waving
at me. And I, quite frankly, I did want to go march up and see what happened because I just had to take the high ground. It literally scared me for my children. I mean, these are evil scum, man. I mean, communists have killed 200 million people, folks. They don't play games. They're running the same destabilization program here. You say it'll never happen. Bull. This country has been rotted from within by a bunch of traitors that have snuck in and infiltrated us. And I'm done with them. And I'm going to identify them. And I'm coming after them. People say, oh, you could have got hurt. You could have got whatever. The point is, I'm not playing around anymore. And it's not because I'm tough or I'm a hero. I'm not laying down to these people. And they really pissed me off. And I'm sick of their crap. Bunch of mass murdering supporters, man. And you see what they're doing. They mean business. And you see the president up there every time innocent police get killed saying, well, we need to reform the police. Basically saying that's why they got killed because they're bad. They deserve to be shot in the back because somebody else somewhere did something wrong. When you look at statistics, our police department in this country this is one of the most violent nations on earth. It always has been. And per capita, for the amount of violence we have a very restrained police force in this country. Instead, what's happened is they've all gone into a militarized fortress mode, and that's only going to get worse when cops start getting shot in the back. It's a formula to bring the country down. They're building the police state by creating the climate that produces one, so when they take total power, they have a police state in place.
Exactly.
So I'm not against the police. I'm against the globalist program, the architecture. I see them building. I've seen them do it in other countries. The globalists brag. They think we're dumb. They admit their battle plan. And, folks, we got to save this country. Because we're not just getting taken over, as I've said 1,000 times, by Boss Hogg, who just wants to, you know, basically skim money or something. And that'd be bad enough. I'd be against it because it always leads you to something worse. We're at the point of it leading to the worst thing you can have. So the games are over, ladies and gentlemen. The gloves are off. The globalists are attacking. And everybody, I don't care whether you're in a uniform or whether you're a school teacher or whether you're a garbage truck driver, you are a human who deserves freedom. And you're good people. And I don't care if you're in the military or you're a social worker or you're a liberal or you're a conservative, who you are. Through the left, you can have tyranny. Through the right, you can have tyranny. Okay, and the globalists direct both of those throughout history. They write books admitting it like Tragedy and Hope, written for the State Department and the CIA so they could understand, why do we fund fascists and communists? Because they want centralized control. They want to give you fake choices, but then you're always just choosing another flavor of tyranny. There's no doubt tyranny's here. There's no doubt they're coming after free speech, and they're manifesting through the left right now. They're manifesting through the left. The globalists will try to manifest tyranny through the right as well, but we should try to reach out to people on the left and the right who are confused and don't know what's going on and explain all this and then transcend it and then deal with it. But it's time that these communists who try to intimidate people and socialists and BLM and all the Soros-affiliated groups and the Ford Foundation groups know we're not stopping, we're not backing down, we're getting stronger. If we don't identify these people and lay down to them, they win. if we start resisting them in the information war and by physically being there and saying, we're taking the hill, you want to fight, here we are. You started first, see what happens. We win. We get stronger, they get weaker. We're getting stronger, they're getting weaker. You're seeing death throes right now. They've been spending decades rotting out Europe and rotting out the United States for their takeover. And now we've identified it. The people know what's going on. We're moving against it. We're getting stronger, they're getting weaker. We're getting stronger, they're getting weaker. We're getting stronger, they're getting weaker. Day by day, and they're panicking, and they're throwing everything they've got at us in desperation. They admit they're desperate. And I'm never stopping. I'm never backing down. I'm never giving in. I'm never giving up. Ever, 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 ever in the face of people that wear the uniforms of the greatest mass murderers in history and are allied against our republic. We'll be back. Stay with me. We've got a lot of different videos that we can air. And coming up, the start of the next segment, Diamonds and Silk should have arrived. But again, there's a lot of issues getting through the security cordon. Because we're actually inside where the convention's going on itself in a private studio building that's part of the complex, as viewers can actually see if you're watching on television right now on TV stations and cable systems around the country, but also for free at Infowars.com/show. Briefly, because I've been neglecting to do this, this is a massive expenditure, obviously, of money for any media organization. And we're a mom-and-pop independent organization that's got about 55 people in it. And then, of course, auxiliary reporters and contractors and folks, less than 100 people total. Having the effect, media-wise, punching through the Berlin Wall of controlled disinformation that is mainstream media, punching through with a searing, flame-throwing, white-hot spotlight of truth, just crashing through the lies of disinformation. Unapologetically taking the enemy on head on, like a rampaging 18-wheeler, running over the jihadis instead of the jihadis running over us, but in the information war. And the globalists are allied with every radical, hateful, out-of-control group that you can imagine, and they're creating total distractions, total diversions with things like, did Melania Trump lift some lines about heritage in her family? I mean, everybody says that in the speech. I've talked to Roger Stone, and I've also talked to some of our other sources that obviously go unnamed. But the bottom line is that Lewandowski, who has been a troublemaker all along inside the campaign, I've never talked about that in the year and a half that I've had some knowledge of the campaign, not just from Stone, but from others. Everything Stone ever told me then came true, or was already had happened and was proven later. Basically everything. I don't think I've ever seen Stone be wrong, quite frankly. And I talk to him every day, sometimes multiple times a day. He's just a really interesting guy. In fact, after this campaign's over, I tend to keep talking to Stone. He's a fun guy. He's the type of guy you take on vacation with you. I mean, he's just really funny, really smart, a real guy. But anyways, enough bromance there. He's going to tell you the inside scoop on Fox. And he told me the inside scoop on Fox 6 months ago. He told me the inside scoop a month ago. He told me the inside scoop, I'm going to go ahead and just let you know, a week ago. And that's why you heard me go ahead. And he said, yeah, it's starting to come out. You can talk about it. But then I talked to other people at Fox, obviously. I don't want to get them in trouble. Tucker Carlson is not one of my sources. I don't ever bring up Fox News stuff with them. But I do talk to him sometimes off air. And it's amazing. Absolutely amazing. What's going on at Fox News. In fact, I wish I would have made a bigger deal about this a few weeks ago when I was authorized to start talking about it. But quite frankly, it's so off my radar, Fox News itself and how arrogant Fox News is and how Fox News thinks it's God and so many of its personalities are just unbelievably narcissistic, I guess would be the word, that I just, it's really not on my radar screen. I mean, here's the thing. I know what Fox News is. I know what it's designed to do. But what they're now doing to it is big news. What is now happening at Fox News is going to happen to everybody else. And so many people I see on InfoWars and Prison Planet are saying, oh, great, I hope Fox News falls apart. Oh, I'm glad that the Murdochs are about to take it left. Screw it, it'll just collapse. The fact that they're getting ready to bring down Fox News, everyone, shows you they understand that they have to completely shut down the Liberty Movement and even the artificial one that was there to control things. Now that it's failed and has been radicalized, it's got to be controlled, demoed. And when I say this, folks, you need to understand, what you're hearing is the facts, okay? Now, I could see this from afar, knowing the different players, years ago. And I knew they were using the whole hacking scandal to threaten the Murdoch empire to make him come closer to Hillary. We knew this 4 years ago. And we told you this was happening. And he, you know, gives more money to Hillary than he does Republicans. And you've seen some folks trying to follow orders like Bill O'Reilly and start, you know, being nice to Hillary, saying nice things about Hillary. There's a lot that goes into this. So when we come back, I'm going to try to just give you what's happening without going down rabbit trails to back it up. But just understand, they're taking Fox News down right now, and then they're going to take Rush Limbaugh down. They're going to take Matt Drudge down. And you're like, oh, well, you know, Drudge, you know, he's a great guy, but so what? Or oh, Limbaugh, you know, that guy's, you know, been kind of a warmonger. The point is, the globalists aren't going to leave him around, okay, because they know he's pro-gun and doesn't hate America, okay? No one is going to be left on air unless you want to bring the country down, okay? They've got dossiers on everybody. They know Donald Trump. They know people like Limbaugh love the country. And they're not New World Order people. And it's going to get so bad in this country that they're not going to be allowed to be on air. Then they're going to start arresting people, okay? This is how this works. So all the conservatives, libertarians going, yay, Fox News is going to fall. No, it's horrible. It's bad news, folks. It shows how authoritarian things have gotten. Boy, I tell you, it is just an amazing time to be alive right now. Diamonds and silk are arriving here, I guess, in the next 5-10 minutes. And we, again, have Ted Nugent coming up. We have my crew right now interviewing Nigel Farage. I can't wait to air that, maybe even to the fourth hour. That's amazing. I tell you, I almost said that's it, just walked into that building with him so I could go meet him in person. I've never done that, but I just came to the show. So, yes, I'm like a fanboy. You know, I want to go meet the rock star. Well, he's a patriot, man. He just got the beginning of the UK out of the EU and a serious blow to the globalists. And I know they'll reconfigure and come back again. That's the animating contest of liberty. Point is, we are kicking their butt. But guys want to meet some quarterback that's won the Super Bowl 4 times? I could care less, quite frankly. I mean, I could just care less. I want to meet people that are defending my family and who've been, you know, who they've tried to murder repeatedly, and then you just keep fighting back. But that's because I'm an extremist, ladies and gentlemen. That's the kind of stuff I'm into. And again, folks, I like football as much as the next person. The point is, this country is in such dire straits that I don't care about football anymore. Just 15 years ago, I still watched football. I even watched the Red Sox the last time they went to the World Series again. I mean, I get it. I'm not judging you. The point is, we're being taken over, ladies and gentlemen. And so, yeah, I went to Dallas Cowboy games when I was a kid. Okay, great. You know, my grandfather was like super good buddies, best buddies in college. And then when they went to World War II, both in the Army Air Corps with, you know, Tom Landry. The point is that that's not that exciting to me. Okay. What's exciting to me is we are on the verge of crushing the globalist. Liberty is rising, and no amount of manipulation, no amount of betrayal, even if Trump's an operative, which I don't think he is, no amount of that can put it back together again if we just stand up. That's where I'm going. Now, on the Fox News situation, Roger Ailes worked with patriots at the FCC in the mid-1980s with the head lawyer, head counsel, Mr. Fine, who again comes on the show and nobody even cares. This is the guy that fought and battled to have free speech again on talk radio. You couldn't go on the radio and criticize the left. They would let leftists have talk shows, but then nobody listened. But you couldn't supposedly be political. That's what they want to bring back, folks. And Roger Ailes, say what you want about him. He now, they're trying to oust him for hugging Megyn Kelly 6 years ago. And I know people that know Roger Ailes, they say the guy is super nice, super funny, super weird, quirky. He's super old and sick now. And they're just trying to kick him out because he had the formula of women in news. He's the guy that brought women in to dominate news. Say what you want about it. I mean, he wrote the book on it all. He created Fox News. That was a counter to CNN. And even though it was synthetic, and even though Rupert Murdoch was in there trying to make it go more left, Ailes was able to basically block that for a long time. Now you notice Fox News has been totally anti-Trump, done every dirty trick you can imagine. And this is part of a dirty trick to bring down Roger Ailes and everyone that supports him. And I think it's genius. And you can go to drudgereport.com and see all the coverage of this. InfoWars has some coverage, but Drudge has it all. I'm going to cover it more later in the broadcast. That dozens of their top people, including Hannity and others, are saying, we're going to leave if you get rid of Ailes. Because if they all leave, they can go create another competing network as a group of personalities with Ailes, and that will defeat Fox. See, they don't want that, though. The globalists want everybody to kind of stay there and then slowly fire people and slowly intimidate people. A lot of folks have said, hey, why have you been nicer to Sean Hannity lately? Well, he's gotten more hardcore. And I knew not from Roger Stone, who is a consultant and works for Fox. I mean, he wears that, you know, hat. And I'm not going to get into, you know, inside baseball on that. I've learned a lot more from other people higher up at Fox. I'm going to stop right there. But everything Stone's told me meshes with that. You notice Stone hadn't been on Fox in 6 months. That is Hillary Clinton through Rupert Murdoch. Okay? And that is the direct orders to Roger Ailes. And it's not just him. It's dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of people. MSNBC and CNN, you notice, banned him at the same time. And suddenly he wasn't on Fox either. That's because they didn't want to announce the ban. Okay, this is a Hillary White House order. And they keep warning Ailes. You let Trump go on there. You let Hannity talk about rape. We're coming after you. And so this is an internal war at News Corp, at Fox. A lot of folks sit there and go, good, let them fall. You're going to get bigger. A lot of people at Fox have told me that. I don't, you understand, it's part of a globalist program. Sure, it's fake conservative, a lot of it, but still, the good stuff that gets out, the globalists hate, and they want to strangle it. They want to make it super conservative light, put a bunch of leftist garbage in there. Megyn Kelly's been brought in on all this. She's on an evil witch-like power trip with Rupert Murdoch and his sons. And these are horrible, horrible people, okay? I mean, when you see Megyn Kelly, folks, she is evil, anti-American, dangerous, and a damn liar on top of it, okay? And, oh my gosh, he told women they were pretty. Oh my gosh, he hugged her and squeezed her. Oh my, oh, this is so horrible. This is the most evil thing I've ever heard of in my life. Meanwhile, the Clintons are running around murdering people, launching wars, having hundreds of thousands of Christians killed all over the Middle East, overthrowing our allies, doing the most horrible stuff you can imagine, covering up all these rapes, settling rape cases. Make no mistake, folks, they're going to go after Fox. They're going to go after Drudge. They're going to go after, they've already basically come in with Goldman Sachs money and taken over almost all of Clear Channel. Okay? Say what you want about Clear Channel. Years ago, they battled some of their top executives who are actually listeners of mine and put me on SiriusXM. That was a big, bold move. And you know why they did it? They did it because they're worried about their kids. And they said, we hope what you do spreads and other talk show hosts pick it up because it's the truth. And you know what? It did happen. People at Clear Channel purposefully infected Clear Channel with me. They even, under the radar, put me on some other stations. Okay? I don't want to even talk about this, but it's time people understand and know what's going on. Okay? There are patriots at Fox News. There are patriots inside Clear Channel. One of them is George Norrie, who took that show from all UFOs and chupacabras to 80% serious news at a serious risk to his job. They said, okay, you go ahead and do this, but you know, you fail or whatever. You notice he made the show even bigger. So there are people that have done everything they can within the system to try to save this country. And George Norrie, Roger Ailes, people like that. And look, Roger Ailes isn't perfect by any stretch of imagination. I was offered weekend shows with them to start. And they're like, oh, of course, and we'll fly you. And I'm like, even if you get fly me first class every week, it's not that I'm some big star or something. I'm not going to be cramped on an airplane with my back troubles and stuff. You know, I mean, I've been body slammed, folks, straight into concrete in high school and stuff like that. I've got probably, you know, brain damage and stuff. I just have got not a lot of health issues. I'm pretty healthy in a lot of ways, but I've been through a lot. I'm not trying to bitch. I just don't want to sound like I'm sitting here. Oh, I got to be first class. That sounds horrible. And the truth is, I need to sit in first class. I can't sit in a regular plane seat. My shoulders are too wide. And, I mean, of course, anybody knows that. A small man can hardly sit in one. The point is, I'm digressing. And then they're like, you don't want to show on Fox. And I said, nope, I don't want to show on Fox. And then the offers got bigger and bigger, okay? So that's why I love later in the New York Daily News, they said that I had asked for a show and that I didn't get one and that I was mad. That was one of the so-called unnamed Fox executives. That wasn't a Fox executive. That was a Glenn Beck producer that was still there. That's the world of these people. So, oh, let me finish the story because it's one of the most important things I've ever talked about. I'm sorry I digress into spinal issues. Like two of the, in my, one of my neck are almost completely, you know, fused now. But anyways, you talk about it when your head's hurting. Sorry, my neck's hurting. That's why I always do that on air. And then I'll start telling people why I do certain tics and things. And I don't know. The point is that this is so epic what's going on right now. And it makes me completely sick. Okay. Because you notice I didn't finish the rest of the story, did I? Glenn Beck. It isn't about Glenn Beck sneaking around behind the scenes, always trying to sabotage me and not have radio stations carry me and get my sponsors and the rest of it. It's that he's a Benedict Arnold who knows they're getting ready to take out conservative and libertarian and patriot media. So he's going to NBC and trying to get a meet the press job. Oh, yeah. And going on there and saying, vote for Hillary Clinton. I mean, the guy is literally Judas Iscariot, except he doesn't have the decency to go hang himself the next day. I mean, he doesn't have the decency because he's worse than Judas. Judas felt bad about being intimidated into betraying Christ. He loves it. He absolutely loves it. And that's why you see all this. Megyn Kelly and him and all of them are getting ready for the purge. And thank God, Sean Hannity, who I know risked his job. I know he's been threatened and told, get ready to lose your job. And I know he has pressure through Clear Channel as well to back off Hillary. And you know what? He hasn't been doing it. And now you've got dozens of them. Some are saying 30 are threatening to leave now. I mean, it was just a few last night, if they bring down Roger Ailes. So that's good. That's American fighting spirit. And now maybe those people can understand that I was right all along about the level of tyranny and how dangerous things are. And that it doesn't matter down the road if we have a right-winger in office that tries stuff like this. You've got to stand against it. Because this country and our children are in deep trouble. And this world is in deep trouble. This isn't a game, people. And it comes down to your soul. Do you want to be with Glenn Beck? And do you want to be with Megyn Kelly, these evil, narcissistic, horribly dark betrayers? I mean, is that who you want to be with in your life? I'm talking to the listeners. That's what this comes down to. I mean, thank God that I'm with mavericks and patriots like Matt Drudge and Joseph Farah and other folks like that. And people like Tucker Carlson, who wasn't that hardcore years ago. But as it became safer to fight the New World Order, he starts doing it because now he's able to. People are showing you their true colors right now, ladies and gentlemen. That's what happens when stuff starts to get bad, okay? That's what happens. And I cannot express to you enough how much danger this country is in. It's teetering on the edge. They are inches away from activating jihadi sleeper cells that'll bring in martial law. They are. The BBC is announcing, oh, we're looking at stop saying the word terrorist altogether. And people say, oh, they're floating it. Yeah. No, they're going to do it now. They always say, should we not say mother and father? And then they ban it in government forms. Then they tell the kids don't use it. The kids are like, mother and father is bad? Yes, it hurts someone who doesn't have it. Talk about class warfare, dividing people if they have a mother or father. Or don't talk about how you have a mother and father. That might hurt someone who doesn't. I mean, do-do-do-do, like don't. I mean, that's later, the test tube babies. You know, some people are from test tubes. That's what they're, or I told you this was coming a decade ago. Persecution of robots, and now it's in all the movies, and we need rights for AI, you see. Oh, yes. I mean, I can see their whole plan, and I understand why other people who didn't read globalist white papers, who didn't sit around reading 1,100-page text, 1,200-page text, and World War II, you know, secret wartime reports that were declassified, and psychological warfare manuals of the Soviets and the British. I mean, I've done the research, okay? And I was younger then, I had a photographic memory, and I could just read a book in hours. Now, don't have a photographic memory anymore. It's kind of pleasing, I'll be honest with people. Because before everything, I'd see information. It was just like my head would burn. You know, it was just like knowing so much and seeing what's the patterns, and other people don't see it. They don't understand. And I'm telling you, folks, I'm nothing special, but I'm kind of an idiot savant at larger political systems and what's really behind them. And it's proven that my view of the world and how it operates is more accurate than the disinformation view the globalists put out on purpose. This is not rocket science. Now, again, there's a lot of checkpoints. It's hard to get people in and out. We have to be searched by the Secret Service whenever we come into here. And we're going to get stacked up today with guests. But Diamonds and Silk are coming in. Hey, ladies, come on in here. Jump on in, beautifuls. Hey, it's good to have you here. We're talking about how they're trying to bring down Fox News and the rest of the independent media. Because after they take down the lead elephant, they're going to try to take everybody down. And the metaphor is intended. Come here, sweetheart. How are you doing?
Hey.
How are you guys doing?
Hey, we're doing wonderful.
You are sweethearts to be here and go through all that trouble to get here. Tell folks, everybody knows who you are, but plug your websites. Tell folks, you know, I mean, about your fight, why you're supporting Trump. And I would imagine you're more proud now than ever.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Well, we're supporting Trump because he wants to keep us safe and secure.
Exactly.
He wants to bring back jobs where we can thrive. And he wants to unite this country and bring back spirit. So that's why we're supporting us.
And we're excited.
Uh-huh.
What has it been like, ladies, for you personally? And I know you guys are positive about getting Donald Trump, who isn't an America hater. I mean, he just didn't have to get the country. That's good enough for me. What do you make, though, of the threats you've gone through? And I mean, I know you guys... You know, we weren't even able to speak at the rally a while back, but we ended up coming anyways because of the death threats and things. I mean, we should talk about the so-called left. These people don't act like any liberals I ever knew before. What's happened to these people?
Well, we don't know what's happening to the left, but these death threats, we haven't heard anything about no death threats. We've never received death threats. So we don't know who made up that malicious lie.
Okay, good.
You know, there is no way that we would have missed our man in this event for Donald J.
Okay,
Trump.
Good. Well, I mean, I guess they were putting that out then. So you wouldn't come and others wouldn't come and it would scare people away. But then now I learned it wasn't true.
That's not true.
Right.
And we made every event, even the Citizens for Trump rally.
Yes.
We were able to go out there and speak and we had a phenomenal time.
See how their disinformation works? It is a wall of lies.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we don't know if the left started something to stir up something. We don't know where it came from.
But getting back to that, you guys haven't ever been threatened? I mean,
No, we stand up to people. We got, listen, Alice. We are not afraid of people. I will stand.
I know that didn't sound like you guys. Well, sure.
I was.
Well, certainly your word. Trump's had a lot of threats. There's been a lot of attacks at his rallies.
Listen, we don't. The more they hate, the more we have to educate the people. That's what it's about. So we don't get into the riffraff with people. We don't
understand. My audience gets it. They're like, I'd say 95% Trump. And as the whole elite comes after him more, you know, the 5% that weren't are getting on board. But I mean, behind the scenes, you guys have got to know Trump really, really good. I mean, what's it like knowing Trump himself behind the scenes?
Listen, he's a person that loves America, loves Americans.
Yes.
Want to just know that you're making it. Want to know that you're doing more than making it. You're thriving and not just surviving. Yeah. He's present. He's tentative. So when he's talking to you, you have his undivided attention.
He's a very humble man. Mm-hmm. He loves all Americans. Mm-hmm. He don't care if you're red, black, white, blue. He don't care what color you are. Yeah, he don't care.
Be honest, you ladies are a little bit sweet on him, aren't you?
Well, I always say Donald Trump is my man. I love Donald. Listen, I love a person. Do you know what I like about him? We've had the first African-American president. Not one time have he ever said, I'm going to do something for African-American.
That's right.
But Donald Trump is bold enough to say, you know what? I'm going to be the greatest president for African-Americans. I'm like, he's not embarrassed of us as African-Americans. He acknowledges us. That's why I'm pulling for Donald Trump.
Yeah. Well, yeah, Donald Trump, people have known forever, they just say he likes real people.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Because he's a real person. Yeah,
that's right.
He's real.
But to have the first black president never mentioning nothing about you,
right?
But then having Donald Trump, I'm going to be good for you too. Don't you worry. We got you too.
Well,
you
said specifically, we're going to come with actual jobs.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yes.
And that's what we need. Listen,
Obama doesn't want that. He wants everybody under his control.
We don't need an Obama phone. Give people good jobs. They can buy their own phone with me.
We're here in Cleveland. Where the Obama phone lady's from. And I tell you, I've gotten to know her. She's a sweet lady. But it's so sad. She really just thinks, you know, that somehow somebody's got to save her.
That's being handed the crumbs.
Mm-hmm.
See, they so conditioned and used to being handed the crumbs.
Mm-hmm.
The crumbs of, give me this little phone.
Yeah.
How is that going to help you make it?
Mm-hmm.
How is that going to help you thrive?
That's right.
You see what I'm saying?
I couldn't believe him when he said what Obama said. He was actually going to get that lady a house, that he didn't actually follow through to get, at least for her. It had to be some local Republicans that did it. That was so mean to say, we're going to take care of you living in your car, and then doesn't even do it.
But he don't have a problem with helping illegal immigrants.
Get cars.
That's right.
Houses and food and medical.
The whole system is flawed.
Yes.
So when somebody like Donald Trump come and say, you know what, this system is flawed. This system is going to work for Americans and we're going to put Americans first. What? Yes, we're going to vote for him.
Yes.
Ladies, give out your websites.
Oh, diamondandsilk.com. You can follow us on Twitter, Diamond and Silk. Like us on Facebook, Diamond and Silk. Everything is Diamond and Silk.
Just Google us,
Diamond and Silk.
Well, you guys are awesome. You know, what I love is I've had some rallies here. I mean, the rally you were at as well. And it was wonderful. It was, I think at least a third of the people at the Trump rally that I was with you the other day were black Americans. That is so good.
Oh, yes.
to challenge the media narrative that if you're in the Tea Party, you're racist. That is intended to actually make people believe that so they don't have a chance if they're libertarians or if they're conservatives. I mean, that's a big insult to just say you're not allowed to even come to this.
Well, I'm going to tell you what. Black people, white people are coming off of that Democratic plantation, baby. And they are jumping on the Trump train.
Uh-huh.
And they keep wanting to put out this here little stigma. Oh, well, he may not have African Americans. He have African Americans.
Oh, yeah.
Some of them are closeted because they don't want to be ostracized. But he have black people that's going to be voting for him. Because you know what? They want to come up. They want to thrive again. Someone wants to be entrepreneurs.
Well, it's like when they say he hates gays and then he was one of the biggest advocates for people that have equal rights 30 years ago before it was cool. It's just everything's a lie.
The left-wing media spinning a lie. Go ahead.
They want to keep us segregated. They want us to segregate ourselves by race or gender.
Mm-hmm.
But Donald Trump wants us to be united as one, as all Americans.
It's so obvious, too.
Yes.
It's the opposite of what Martin Luther King said 40 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And RFK and JFK said, it's literally segregation's what the left's pushing. And
absolutely.
It's crazy. Yes.
And then what happens is, as soon as something happened, where you see it looked like a cop has killed a black boy or African-American, now they pulling at the heartstrings of African-Americans.
Yes.
And then African-Americans go out in the street, pump their fists. Black Lives Matter movement started, and they block traffic. And the same people that you protesting against is the same people that's risking their lives to protect you. They don't want to come to the table, you know, because to come to the table and to solve this problem, oh, that means the money stopped, the propaganda stopped.
Right.
The tables are not out there in the streets.
It's
they're here.
Inside.
They're inside.
That's
where
right.
we can sit down, how do we solve problems?
Exactly.
Instead of marching, pumping your fists, and acting a fool in
That's
the streets,
right.
it's crazy.
And the same system in the street doing pumping their fists on, it's the same system they keep voting for.
Because it was the Clintons that put the crime bill into law.
That's
it was
right.
the Democrats that started all this.
I know why Trump's always hugging on you, ladies.
Yes.
I'll tell
it's
you.
It's the truth.
You know, close
it's
you guys in person. I like your energy.
Hey. Yes, we love you. Yes.
Let me ask you guys a question.
Okay.
What do you guys make of the attempts to bring down the conservatives at Fox News and Roger Ailes? And this whole thing that's going on where the left is trying, and that's from inside, it's a fact, they're trying to bring down Fox News right now.
Well, we don't want that to happen. I hope everything work out well. That's all I can say. I don't know what's going on, but we want everything to work out well.
Well, there was a coup in Turkey or a counter coup. This is a coup at Fox News.
It is so sad.
Anything to silence the truth.
Oh, yeah, they're moving against free speech. I'm going to tell you, folks, they bring down Fox News. They're going to bring down everybody else in their free speech. Mm-hmm. We better use it
they're
or lose
everything
it.
Because that's all we really got. That's really all we got.
Yes.
Everything else is just lean to the left.
Mm-hmm.
So we praying for them and everything. Everything could work out well.
But it's so sad that the left is doing everything they can do to try to save crooked Hillary.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
They don't want to bring her down.
No.
But we ain't letting no crook off the hook.
I'm sure you ladies get this, but I just feel the energy.
No, we're very passionate.
No, but I mean, it's not just your words. I can feel the energy.
Oh, really? Yeah.
You know, when you find this country over $19 trillion in debt, you have people that are unemployed, people standing on the corners with a sign, holding a sign saying we'll work for food. What in the heck is the current administration doing to change that?
And why would the current administration think that we should vote for that same system for another 4 to 8 years?
Right.
When you ain't done that, you had almost eight years to do something.
Exactly.
And you had not anything.
Well, that's Cloward and Piven. They admit they want us poor. And now Bilderberg Group met this year and admitted, they put a press release out, we want to make you poor and give you a stipend every month to control you. They actually said, we want to control you, we want you poor.
Yeah.
So they're now, the conspiracy theorists are right again.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
what they want to do. They want to keep you codependent on the government. Uh-huh. And once they keep you there, they can control you.
They say,
sugar ain't for free.
That's right. And they're not going to give you the best stuff. Now, when they give you the crumbs, it's going to be the bare minimum.
The bare minimum.
Well, in fact, that's what they said in his big paper. He won a bunch of awards for this professor. He's a state what the system is.
Mm-hmm.
He said, it's the Walmart model. I'm not tagging Walmart. This is what they do.
Okay.
Where they pay you just enough But then you're still able to get welfare. They don't pay you above that so that you work 8-10 hours a day, but then you got to go to the government and get something on top of it just to live. That's the big conspiracy. Wow. And Donald Trump wants to break that.
Absolutely. Yes. And yes. I believe he is going to break that. Yes. See, that's why when you get out, you want to make sure you register to vote. And you want to make sure you vote for Donald Trump, because I believe he can come in and clean up all of this insider mess. Oh, he can clean it up.
I agree. A lot of people are closeted about Trump, and I think that's why he's going to have a landslide unless there's election fraud.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
This is going to be amazing.
This is going to be, listen, he's going to be the 45th president of the United States.
Yes.
And well, you know what? No weapon formed against him is going to prosper.
None.
So whatever the left is trying to do is going to prosper.
Yes.
You ladies are amazing. We're going to go to break. Come up with a few more minutes. I know you've got a schedule. I've got a schedule. But it was rough to get in here. Boy, a lot of security.
Yeah. Oh, a lot of security.
Yes.
But you know what? We feel safe. Thank you, police officers.
Thank you.
I love y'all. I've been hugging on them.
Yes.
Oh, and they fine, too, Alex. Mm-hmm. Too, so I can't on them like that.
Yes.
But
yes.
They've been really keeping us safe. Secret Service,
safe.
I love it. We feel very safe here in Cleveland.
And even your people.
Thank you all for everything, just making sure we were secure. I love y'all for that.
Thank you.
What do you guys think about this whole thing with Trump's wife? I mean, I looked at that speech. That's what everybody says about their roots and their parents. And that's not plagiarizing. That's like saying, I'm so honored to be here. I mean, that's just something, the few lines she said that were like Michelle's, that's something everybody says.
Listen.
I mean, how do you plagiarize?
She gave a phenomenal speech.
Awesome.
And what's happening is the Clinton is threatened.
Yes.
She feels threatened by Melania. Mm-hmm. And so that's why they put those malicious lies out on the
arm. And on a daily basis, we say, make America great again.
Does that mean we plagiarizing that?
No.
We say it all the time.
Exactly. Plagiarized speech is big chunks.
Absolutely.
And claiming credit for it all.
Exactly.
We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, with Diamond and Spill. I'm Alex Jones. Ted Nugent's coming up. Talk about a jam-packed transmission. These ladies are about to run in about 5 minutes. They are going to do another interview, fighting for this republic. We got Ted Nugent coming up. And we also have coming up right now in the elevator, Roger Stone. And we're going to talk about inside the battle at Fox. And these ladies were aware of the big mix-up at Fox, but they weren't aware of the full import, because this is a coup. We need articles in InfoWars. We need everyone to explain. I have inside Fox sources. Other people do. I'm going to ask Stone about this. And what my sources told me, in fact, Stone's here now, there is a war to shut down right now, as we speak, Fox News in an election year, 3 months out from the election. And it's Megyn Kelly claiming Roger Ailes squeezed her too hard, because the ladies were hugging me during the break. And I'm going to get another one here in a minute. And imagine that's what they're trying to bring down Fox News with, to literally turn it into CNN during an election. This is sabotage. This is a coup, but of the media, just like what you saw in Turkey. It's very serious. What do you ladies make of that?
Well, you know, I think it's very sad. Mm-hmm. I think that people need to start getting their facts straight, getting mm-hmm. everything together.
Yes.
Because we don't need to lose. When we cut on our TV, we want to see conservative television, conservative news.
That's
so
right.
If we lose Fox, what else do we have on television? Because everything else tend to lean left.
That's right.
So I just hope everything work out, and it's going to work out for everybody.
Well, we're going to have to go to the underground. We're going to have to do it like networking back
That's
and
right.
forth.
That's right. Absolutely.
You know, we got
Alex Jones here.
We have Alex Jones. Because we got to get Donald Trump into the White House.
Right.
Well, that's why I put airplanes in the sky with Hillary for president. It's why I've got billboards driving around with InfoWars, you know, learn the truth.
Yes.
It's why we got 94.5, which is a pirate, but it doesn't hurt the other stations,
mm-hmm.
which is broadcasting here in Cleveland,
yes.
You know, just during this event. So the people's media is under attack. We turn the heat up.
We got to do what we got to do.
That's right.
We have to use what we have to
That's
get
right.
what we want.
Absolutely.
That's
I
what
love,
we got to do.
I love it. I love
yeah, there's a camera crew here. I thought that was Stone.
Stone's with.
Oh, Stone's here?
Yeah, he's here.
Oh, he's in the bathroom. Okay. All right. Well, ladies, you're awesome. I can't believe that we're sitting here. I can't believe we're sitting here talking about them trying to bring down Fox News. They're trying to bring down Clear Channel. They're trying to bring down talk radio. They admit they want the return of the Fairness Doctrine. They are trying to openly censor the internet. They have the Federal Elections Commission admitting they want to shut Drudge down. I mean, folks, Drudge came here to warn us last year to our studio. I mean, this is real. We've got to rally together now
to
defend this republic.
Exactly.
That's right. We love Drudge. We love Matt Drudge. We love Drudge.
Yes.
So we don't want nobody touching
Well, ladies,
up.
I mean, the attacks here, and Americans aren't used to seeing this type of Soviet-style censorship or fascist censorship.
Yes.
So, we're kind of like not used to it, like dodo birds weren't used to being hunted, so they all got mm-hmm. killed. This is happening. We got to raise the alarm now.
Yeah.
This
we
is really going on.
Speak.
This is really unfolding. This
yes.
is the battle for the republic.
So
and they wouldn't be shutting Fox down and you know, taking it over if they weren't threatened.
That's right.
Totalitarianism that we're facing here.
Yeah. So it's not free press, it's control press is what they're trying to do now. It's
absolutely. Well, ladies, we're going to go out to break here, but I'm going to get a hug here with you guys. Thank you so much. You are just awesome. God. Thank you so much. It's the battle for the Republic, folks. We got to come together. Diamond and Silk.
Love you. Love
Thank you so much. You ladies are awesome.
Thank you so much.
Those ladies have a lot of energy, folks. We're going out to break. I'm getting Stone in here. We'll go out to break with myself getting physically attacked. It's all right, folks. We're going to, we'll go out to break. Stay with us. And we're going to get Stone here. Stay with us.
Chaotic out here. This is Rob Dewar reporting for Infowars.com. It is getting chaotic. It looks like the communist started to attack Alex, and he defended himself.
Crazy time.
Oh yeah. Excuse me.
I was just talking to Roger during the break. Thank you for joining us. Ted Nugent's coming up. Bottom of the hour, and I was talking about the fact that yes, we're having some major victories, and Trump's been nominated. We defeated them trying to steal the election. We saw Hillary openly steal it in a horrible fashion from Bernie Sanders. So this country's in trouble, and so just like they have coups in foreign countries, there's coups in major media operations. Just like Ted Cruz tried to take over the Phyllis Schlafly operation, or at least somebody in his crew did. This is much bigger. There is a coup at Fox. I'm not getting this from Stone, though he confirmed some of it for me. He, of course, has a lot of contacts in Fox and works as a consultant for him for years. And so I'm just filling you in on the fact that from my sources, this is a real coup over Roger Ailes hugging women when they hug him, just like I hugged Diamond and Silk earlier when they were here. So for me, this is the biggest issue. Yes, we're having victories. Yes, the mainstream media is on its heels at certain levels, but if they take down Fox, and you're talking about dozens of people trying to leave, Sean Hannity, you name it. That's why I've been defending Hannity lately, saying he's got courage, because I know from sources he's been threatened to be fired, his contract not to be renewed in a few years, if he keeps basically letting Trump talk about rape. That's the big no-no. It's why he's been not on Fox in 6 months, even though he works there. And I don't mean to give inside baseball, this from other people. Roger, tell me if I'm wrong. This is not from Stone. I have other contacts. And it's not Tucker Carlson either that I had dinner with the other night. This is going on. This is a major coup. I knew about it 6 months ago. And now they're implementing it right before the election. It's a very bold move. Roger, how big a deal is this?
Look, I think it's huge. Let me be very clear. I'm not a contributor at Fox, so I have no self-interest in my comments today. This is, I think, the move of the globalists, sons of Rupert Murdoch, who would like Fox to be more like CNN, who would like Fox to be more like the Sky Channel in the UK. That, of course, from a business point of view, would be an enormous mistake, because the conservatives will merely go elsewhere. They'll go to InfoWars. They'll go elsewhere. Also, I've known Roger Ailes for almost 50 years. I know him as a family man. I knew him when he was younger. These are ridiculous charges. Among other things, one thing no one has ever accused Roger Ailes is of being stupid. See, the idea that he would, that he would stick it in the company inkwell, as it were, is just out of the question. Roger Ailes could have any beautiful woman he wants. He is very wealthy based on his success of building the monolith that is Fox. So knowing him as I have no doubt whatsoever that these charges are trumped up BS. If he indeed leaves Fox, Fox will not be the richer for it. Fox will be surpassed by a new conservative network. Look, the other thing I could tell you is Ailes has one more launch in him. He's got one more act in him. So if he is discharged, I think he'll have the opportunity to build a new cable news network.
Plus, those people are all trained under him for decades. You take 30 of the people from Fox, that is Fox.
Well, and the people who know him best, like Sean Hannity, like Monica Crowley, like Judge Andrew Napolitano, these people are my friends. They will all tell you this is nonsense. This is trumped up charges to try to remove a major conservative voice from the media. So I have ultimate confidence in Roger Ailes, and I hope he fights these charges because they are ridiculous. Also, why did Gretchen Carlson wait so long to make these accusations? Why did she only make them when her career appeared to be in jeopardy? The other point I would make here is that that Alex is exactly right. This is part and parcel of the effort, which is that we see across the board on cyberspace, on every other medium. I myself have been banned at CNN. I've been banned at MSNBC. Why? Because I'm politically incorrect. I met with a somebody from CNN yesterday. We had a very pleasant conversation, and I said, well, "Why am I? I'm really just kind of curious. It's bad enough that you ban people. That was a tactic for Adolf Hitler, I believe, and Stalin. But you let Ted Cruz come on the air in prime time, attack me by name, and then you don't give me a chance to respond.
So they've taken you off because you're effective and you're not following the White House talking points that you don't talk about rape." We're going to talk about how Donald Trump is real nice to women when he's not married and dates them and treats them real nice. So that's some sexual abuse. But meanwhile, they're settling rape cases for Clinton. And so now they're trying to bring down Roger Ailes the same way. And a lot of people are saying, oh, good. That means we'll get more viewers and listeners. No, that's not how it works. They're coming after Matt Drudge and Rush Limbaugh and Alex Jones next. Guaranteed. Drudge has come here to warn me. I've been warned. I've been warned by other people. He's been warned by Supreme Court Justice, the one that's still alive. I mean, this is a major climate shift, folks, in politics to total totalitarianism. So that's why I wanted to up front and center cover this. We're going to skip this break because the time we have here is so important. This country is in an emergency. And that's why it's important for viewers and listeners. I'm not going to even plug right now. Just go to InfoWarsStore.com, buy the products. Some of the big sales are ending today. Fund our operation. Great products you need. We're self-funded. The enemy has trouble shutting off sponsors this way. This is the future, by the way. This is where the media is going. And so understand, folks, that I don't even want a big giant studio all the time. I don't need one. People want to see how this is real, teleprompter free. You know, I'm going over there to get a glass of water, whatever. This is just real people in the trenches fighting, not putting on airs. Now, let's shift gears into how we counter this and then, more importantly, into the current election. But I really see this as a desperation signal by them to openly destroy or start destroying their Fox franchise with up to 30 of their people now saying they're ready to leave. This is seismic, folks. This is really a political shot heard around the world that they would desperately try to threaten us not to have rallies, try to shut down free speech, ban you on all the networks, basically ban you everywhere, admit you're banned everywhere, except not admit you've been banned at Fox, where I know you were consulted in the past, then suddenly 6 months you haven't been on there. I mean, this really shows they're desperate. Am I right?
Yeah, no, I have been a contributor at Fox, and I have had some notable performances there in which I got a chance to lay out the truth. But most of the mainstream media is afraid of the truth. Here's the biggest point, Alex, which is if we're going to persecute Roger Ailes for what I think are very thin charges of sexual harassment, what about Bill Clinton? What about Bill Clinton and Juanita Broderick and Paula Corbin Jones and the courageous Kathleen Willey and Christy Zurcher, Eileen Wellstone, Helen Dowdy, Becky Brown? This list goes on and on. But the mainstream media ignores sexual assault, ignores Bill Clinton exposing himself to women in an aroused state, ignores Bill Clinton biting his victims, his signature move, as authenticated by Michael Isikoff, then of Time, now of Yahoo, as authenticated by the Roger Morris of The Washington Post. These are not exactly left-wing journalists. Let's be very clear. Bill Clinton is a real sexual predator. And the only reason that Bill Cosby is being prosecuted and Bill Clinton is not is racism. This is racist. And it's time for Bill Clinton to be prosecuted.
Now, let's shift gears into the current campaign. What is Lewandowski, who I've left alone, I'm taking the gloves off, what is the former campaign head, after you were the campaign head for Trump, what on earth is he doing going after the current campaign head, and blaming him for this Trump speech, Mrs. Trump speech. All I know is I looked at both speeches, the transcripts. This is stuff almost everybody says in every speech about their roots and where they came from. I mean, that's like saying Trump plagiarized Make America Great Again. That's from Ronald Reagan. Well, that was said before that, too. I mean, there's certain things like the word Titanic you can't plagiarize. And I just don't think that there's been this problem. But even if there was, Obama's been caught clearly plagiarizing, as speechwriters have before. So much of language has already been used. My issue is, what is he doing running around on TV bad-mouthing the current head of the campaign? That sounds like something a Clinton operative would do.
Well, I think it's obvious that he is putting his own personal self-interest and his grudges against the election of the man he professes to say is his friend and whose candidacy he supports. Look, I think Corey Lewandowski is essentially talentless and that he has a screw loose. His commentary on CNN is inane and self-serving. If there was plagiarism, according to what I just read in the New York Times, it appears that it is the fault of some person, a relatively low level, not in the Trump campaign, but at the Trump organization, someone who was well-meaning and thought they were helping.
That's what I heard. That's what I like about them. They are so mom and pop that they got her words, put together a speech, and then she gave it to what this PR friend's what I heard through the grapevine, that then just put the standard thing you put in all speeches about your roots and your family.
Yeah, but to say that, to come out publicly and say that Trump should fire Rick Gates, a very capable guy who serves as Paul Manafort's right-hand man, or Paul Manafort, who is the guy responsible for crushing the rebellion in the Rules Committee
twice.
And crushing the Flora fight, who is the master political technician when it comes to conventions, this is not serving the candidate well. Now, I happen to know that Lewandowski, inebriated last night, tried to crash the Trump family box and had to be restrained by security guards.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Is this breaking here?
I don't know if that's been printed yet. We may be breaking news, but...
Say that again. Wow.
Corey Lewandowski tried to crash the Trump family skybox last night in an inebriated state and had to be restrained by security guards. This guy is clearly out of his mind. I think he's probably worried about a story that appeared several weekends ago in the New York Post,
Money.
Allegations of embezzling, paying inflated prices for T-shirts and hats and posters and then taking a skim from the vendor. Now, I don't know if that's true, but sooner or later, I would guess there's going to be a formal investigation. So this guy has not only, it appears, tried to damage Trump's candidacy, may have stolen from him, and he's obviously out of control. I just don't know how
some
he can...
Some people can't handle power.
Well, and Donald Trump Jr. Gave an interview earlier today in which he said, we know that Lewandowski is spreading disinformation about the campaign. I heard from a journalist last night who told me very breathlessly, I understand Melania Trump is furious over the speech incident. She's blaming Manafort and she wants Corey Lewandowski back. Every single part of that is a lie, every bit. And under a little bit of cross-examining, it became very clear who her source was.
So, I've been talking to you behind the scenes. He's not a conscious saboteur. He's just an egomaniac buffoon.
Yes, I think that's a good characterization.
Wow. Well,
he's a buffoon in the non-pejorative sense of the word. Go ahead.
Wow, I tell you. Well, we've covered some of the negative because that's stuff we've got to deal with. The system's hitting the panic button because populism's rising worldwide. You got Nigel Farage here with huge crowds, rock star, the Brexit's happening. But the empire is striking back. The special interests, the Republican and Democratic machines have combined forces. They've been all meeting in secret around town. You know, they all said they wouldn't go to the convention, but they're all here,
yes,
sneaking around the shadows. I've seen some of them, so that's been confirmed. Romney and the rest scurrying about literally at night, getting into cars and things. So what is afoot in the king's court? Clearly they know he's who America wants. But clearly there's a lot of subterfuge and cloak and dagger different types of skullduggery taking place.
Yeah, no, this is a perfect moment to pay homage to a guy who is a real American patriot. Senator Bob Dole is here.
He came.
He's supporting the Trump
campaign. His campaign now, too.
I worked for him as a legislative assistant, and I worked in his 1996 campaign. He's here. He's in his 90s. This guy is frail, but he's willing to go out and campaign for the Trump-Pence ticket. He's doing his party duty. Now let's contrast him with the Bushes. Where are they? They're not here. You know why? Because they care only about themselves. They care only about lining their own pockets.
And they also vacation with the Clintons.
And their pockets, and the pockets of their cronies, while their policies have made the country poorer, while their policies have made jobs almost obsolete in this country. So I think it's a great juxtaposition. The Bushes are criminals. I've written a book on this, Jeb and the Bush Crime Family. If you haven't seen it, you can go to Infowars.com and snag it right now. I put that in stark contrast to a true American patriot, a guy who was hit by a shell and had to have his entire body reconstructed because of his service in World War II, Bob Dole. Bob Dole, a true American patriot, a giant compared to the Bushes, just a giant.
The Bushes are a bunch of they're organized crime. And you know, they've got so many even patriots people thinking they're good because, you know, W goes and sees the veterans with the hospital. And I think W is a lot better than, you know, somebody like Cheney. I don't think he actually ran a lot of stuff. But I mean, we're kind of going back in the past. The point is, this is all a referendum on the Clintons and the Bushes. It's time to put them on the ashbin of history. It's time for them to go away.
Yeah, look, the whole rise of Trump is a rejection of 30 years of bipartisan treason at a maximum, of bad decisions at a minimum by the Bushes and the Clintons. What have they jointly given us? Endless war, erosion of our civil liberties, massive debt and borrowing, bailouts for the swindlers and the crooks on Wall Street while average people can't find work, and an expensive, ineffective, inefficient, seemingly incoherent foreign policy. We're for Iraq. No, we're for Iran. No, we're for Iraq. Maybe we should be for Iran. We invariably end up facing guns that we've either given people or sold people. We have a president who can't even figure out who the enemy
is. Trump admits we've been bought off by the communist Chinese, that Hillary's an operative. He openly talks about how we're funding ISIS and Al-Qaeda and is advised by General Flynn that exposed that Obama's running ISIS. I mean, he is just everything he's doing. He doesn't want war with Russia, which the West is clearly starting. Not wanting war with Russia is enough for me to support Trump. I mean, the guy is awesome. I've been told by somebody who's been in business with him and known him for 40 years, Dr. Jerome Corsi, and I mean, I've been talking to, you know, of course, before when Trump calls him up, you know, I mean, the guys know each other pretty well, not as well as you do, obviously. But he said, listen, Alex, I'm not going to get into it, but he said, Trump knows everything when it comes to what you know. He knew it before you were born about the New World Order. And he said he basically has just been keeping quiet the whole time, even though he fought NAFTA and GATT and did some things. And the point is now he's sucker punching them. That's why they're crapping their pants. And he basically is like a libertarian sleeper cell. Is that accurate?
I think he has a very good fix about who these country's enemies are. He has never been a globalist. He's a nationalist. He doesn't believe in the New World Order. He believes in American sovereignty. He doesn't believe in their schemes for trade.
And he knows Russia's barely on its knees. Why attack them?
Well, he doesn't want war with Russia. He wants to reach an accommodation with Russia in which everybody can live in peace. Hillary was the one who wants war with Russia because I'm sure she's taking giant contributions from the munitions factory.
Yeah, sorry, lady. We got kids. We don't want World War III.
So and I have no doubt, knowing Trump for 40 years, Putin would respect Trump. He doesn't respect Barack Obama. He laughs at him. He's a clown. So people say, how would we do to Putin? He might offend him. No, these guys recognize strength. The Russians only recognize strength. Donald Trump is a man of courage. He's a man of integrity. He has got the cojones for a face-to-face with Putin, and he will be a peacemaker, not a war maker. If you want war, vote for Hillary Clinton. She's already telegraphing it. She was a neocon for the Iraq war.
I know. I have these leftists running up to me and attacking me and stuff and getting in my face. And they're like, how dare you warmonger? How dare you warmonger? Hillary. And it's just like the total opposite of reality.
Yes.
I mean, it is crazy. Well, we've only got about 4 or 5 minutes left, and we've got Ted Nugent coming up. I appreciate you coming in through the security cord and all the rest of it. I know you're going to be doing a lot more today. Tell us what else you're going to be up to, Roger Stone, StoneZone.com, and tell us other key tidbits and information that folks should be brought to speed on. I know there's a new T-shirt I heard about.
Yeah, look, first of all, one of the best things about the rally that Alex and I spoke at the other day was the enormous number of Hillary for prison T-shirts, which you can go to the Infowars.com store now and grab yours. And I urge you to do so because get the original article. Once Trump is president, we're going to put that T-shirt in the Smithsonian. You'll be able to see one. Now we are introducing a new T-shirt, which I think folks need to get, telling the real truth about Bill Clinton, who is a serial rapist and abuser of women. This is the Achilles heel of these globalists. And you will soon be able to get this T-shirt at Infowars.com exclusively. Or you can contact us at the Stone Zone or the StoneColdTruth.com, and we'll tell you how to get
it. Absolutely. We're going to be carrying it, but just get it right now. And again, going out there, I'd say a third of the people on the street are wearing Hillary for President shirts. It is unbelievable. And the meme has been the number one search term off and on for a month. We make rape with Bill. We got to make this go full tilt.
Yeah. Well,
in fact, I think I'm going to fly planes and say Bill Clinton's a rapist.
Well, we had hoped.
He can sue me, it's not true.
We had hoped to plaster the city with a poster like this, but the city fathers pointed out that there are certain regulations against that. But in other cities, while Alex is flying the banners, we may just have our snipers, that's what they call people who post these posters, where it's perfectly legal, litter all the swing states.
He settled multiple rape cases. He raped the country. He raped Iraq. He's a rapist.
Absolutely.
He's a public figure. He can go straight to hell.
Absolutely.
I mean, I'm done, man. I'm all in. Briefly, what'd you make of the communists trying to shut us up? So I tried to, go up there and basically take the flag, go to the top. They didn't get too happy about that yesterday.
Well, look, at the rally the other day, you may have noticed that I was sweating so profusely. That's because I was wearing a bulletproof vest. I mean, I get 13 death threats a day, and it's always the same person. It's the same breathy male voice that sounds amazingly like Joe Connison. I don't think it is Joe Connison, but it sure sounds like him. So it is incredible that they blame us for our tactics. We're violent thugs. We're the bad guys. But these people are threatening my family. I had a guy call me this morning, 6:25 in the morning. I've got a bullet with your name on it. I've got a second bullet with Trump's name on it. Hangs up. Tired of this crap. I'm just tired of it. Those are the tactics of the Soros-funded left. I've informed the authorities. And frankly, I've always believed it's those who threaten you that won't hurt you. It's the ones who don't threaten you who
I was about to say, though, they're scared. That's why they're trying to bring down Fox right now. I mean, history is happening. People should be really excited. And notice their intimidation hasn't worked. Thousands of patriots are here. We outnumber the miscreant communists. I'd say 2-1.
Yeah, no, it is very heartening to see all those folks out there yesterday. 3,000 people came to a rally, blistering heat. To hear Alex Jones, to hear Roger Stone, to hear an all-star lineup of patriots talk about their love for this country and what this election's really about.
Well, I've got to say, I mean, look, we're the real liberals, okay? I'm for more freedom. You're for more freedom. The so-called left has turned into a bunch of authoritarians allied with the controlled authoritarian right, and this is the populist resistance to it. Roger Stone, StoneZone.com. We had a big interview we did the other day with you about to come out today as well. We're going to talk some more. I'll see you out there on the floor coming up tonight and tomorrow. Thank you so much, Roger.
Great to be here.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Roger, let me talk to you real quick during the break. Again, folks, we are going to break here. On the other side, we've got Ted Nugent coming up. Infowars.com/show. Spread that link for real coverage of the rebellion against tyranny at the RNC 2016, live from Cleveland. Stay with us. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back live. I was just getting like 15 people out of here during the break. Ted Nugent is scheduled to be calling in. There's always time zone issues and things like that. He is on the road going city to city. Notice Ted Nugent is not at the RNC this year because he was not invited. The RNC itself kept him off the list. I don't blame Trump for that. I blame some of the people that, quote, don't want Trump to be too radical. Well, it's radicalism in the face of radicalism that is no vice, to paraphrase Barry Goldwater. At least I plagiarize him here on air. But as they say, stealing is the, at least words and ideas, is the most sincere form of flattery. And I forget who said that. But I'm being a little bit sarcastic now about the fact that they're claiming that Mrs. Trump is engaged in all of that. But what overshadows everything, and what really is the big issue that everyone should be looking at, is that they're trying to have a coup d'etat at Fox. I mean, that really is the big enchilada. This is a big deal, folks. This signals everything Drudge said is dead on. And I know Drudge was legitimate and was really told that, and I've been told similar things, but this shows that intel he got from that individual and others was accurate. This is the year they're trying to come up to free speech. They're not doing too well. And it's blown up their face in Europe as well. But I tell you, very, very exciting to just know that there's patriots here. And I was just talking to John Ronson, who's obviously a famous author and researcher, who was also here while we had Stone in studio. And he was telling me a lot of behind-the-scenes things. And he said, why haven't you talked about the fact that They're chanting Hillary for prison on the delegate floor. And why haven't you talked about the fact that basically people are shouting, you know, stuff from your show? And I said, listen, I know that's going on, but I'm in a war. I got to just move on to the next thing. And when I tell you about the success we're having, it's so you know you're having success. It's because a lot of folks obviously aren't prominent. They're not known. People don't recognize them. So you don't realize that you're not losing, that you're winning. And yes, it is exciting to hear my talking points, my research, my terms, my angles, smashing through the disinformation and being all over mainline talk radio, all over Fox. They're fighting to keep it off CNN, MSNBC. They are scared to death. But listen, I am not the inventor of this. I am not plagiarizing it either. I am enjoying the birthright of a person who wants to be part of the new renaissance, the system of Americana. Not the problems we've had, but the good things we've had that no one could deny were the best the world ever saw. And I really am just wanting you to know that you are the leadership. You are the resistance. And that's not to make you feel important. It's because that's how we're going to beat these people. There's no way they can shut all of us down. And I tell you, my one big frustration is when I'm out walking on the street or I'm, whether it's Austin, Texas or Cleveland, Ohio, and there's all these great men and women of every race, color, and creed that want to shake my hand, want to take photos with me, want to talk to me. I'm too busy getting to the next place to fight the globalists to sit there and talk to you. And I tell you, hey, I love you. You're great. I got to go. And so I just want folks to know, because I've run into people before that have had their feelings hurt, that, listen, we're not playing games here. Okay, we are taking action. Okay, and when you look at somebody like Ted Nugent, or you look at somebody like Nigel Farage, or you look at somebody like Donald Trump, or you look at somebody like Matt Drudge, these are people that are putting everything on the line because they don't want to be slaves. These are people that are defending this republic, and it's that spirit they're trying to extinguish because it's that spirit that'll bring them down. And Ted Nugent is now on the line. Of course, the Motor City Madman. Now, this is the guy who carries the mantle in the United States now, basically of Chuck Heston and the Second Amendment, and I would say he absolutely fills those shoes and more. I am very honored to be seen as a staunch defender, and I am, of course, of the Second Amendment. But I tell you, we need more of these prominent leaders to get even more hardcore, because it's Ted Nugent's no-nonsense, you know, in their face that has helped us realize we're under attack. He's raised the alarm. So joining us is a true modern Paul Revere. Ted Nugent, thanks for coming on with us.
Well, thanks, Ellis. I appreciate those kind words. I bring you self-evident truth and common sense and logic from the not-so-mean streets of America, traveling all across this country as I have for the last 50 years. And what Alex Jones represents, what Ted Nugent represents, is not alone. It really is the heart and soul of this country, and I see and hear it, feel it, and celebrate it every day of my life. So be strong, be stronger, be more absolute, and know that we, the people, are with you 100%.
Absolutely. If this was a war, which it is, how would you describe it as a general? At what point have we reached? I mean, I see the tide turning against tyrants worldwide. The problem is they're digging their heels in.
Well, the dumbing down of America was on the fast track, and it's come to fruition. When you've got, you know, social movements based 100% on lies, the Black Lives Matter is the most embarrassing of all, and you've got so-called leaders like Barack Obama, whose entire career is based on a lie, and you've got Loretta Lynch literally committing glaring crimes in public, tampering with evidence in Orlando, and then you've got the poster child for Saul Alinsky's book dedicated to Satan and Hillary Clinton, and the whole list of liberal Democrats, and horribly, Alex, so much of the Republican Party has just been a shadow of the freaks on the left. I believe that the culture war has finally awakened a we the people fist in this fight. I believe that the record numbers coming out for Donald Trump, who is anything but perfect, but compared to what the Democrats have put forth, a lying, felon, criminal scam artist like Hillary Clinton and a communist, are you kidding me? Bernie Sanders actually had people show up and cheer him on. In the face of that absurdity, Donald Trump almost comes off as Michael the Archangel. So I see an awakening from this self-inflicted, embarrassing, soulless curse of apathy and disconnect. Finally, people in the asset column of America are realizing that we're being taken advantage of by this administration and this government and this media and academia. And I see a giant awakening out here. I'm on tour every day all summer long. And what makes America strong is finally waking up. So I think the prognosis is better now than in the years that you and I have known each other. I bring you positive spirit, downright a warrior effervescence on the not-so-mean streets of this country.
Absolutely. And folks know that I don't give people cheerleader reports. You don't either. You've come on the show for probably off and on for like 15 years. And, you know, we've had some really negative, you know, broadcasts where we admit how down we are. Not to be fear-mongering, not to be negative, but just to tell folks we're down in the ditch getting our asses kicked. But now we've gotten up and the enemy is getting their butt politically kicked. The problem is they're going to pull out the stops. And I want to talk about that with Ted Nugent of TedNugent.com. Also, of course, you know, writes syndicated columns, so much more. Go see him on his sold out tours when you can around the country. But Ted, I have the inside scoop from Fox from three different people that are currently there, one of them very high up. I knew about this about a year ago, 6 months ago, intensified. I knew it was coming about a week ago. Fake sexual harassment claims. Megyn Kelly saying, you know, that Roger Ailes hugged her too hard 6 years ago. And this is some of the Murdoch people with Hillary. Basically trying to take over Fox. That's why Hannity and a bunch of others are threatening to leave. This is unprecedented that the Clinton machine and the Obama machine is literally threatening to fire Hannity and people behind the scenes if he talks about Bill Clinton's record with women. I mean, there's major censorship. For me, that's a bellwether of an attempted coup that's ongoing at Fox News right now. It really shows us that we're 2 minutes to midnight here. These people know they can't beat our information, so now they're trying to shut us up.
Well, we've seen that forever. I mean, I started this culture war, Alex, back in the 1960s when I was doing rock and roll radio interviews. And people, you know, the disc jockeys, the stoners in the music industry would ask me where all my piss and vinegar and fire and passion for the music comes from. And I'd explain that I was raised in the shadow of Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley and Little Richard and James Brown and Wilson Pickett and celebrate those great black founding fathers. And then I would also insert how I just wrapped up a wonderful weekend with my dad and brothers and mom and sister in the deer hunting camp. And I was aim small, miss small, disciplined in the world of hunting and the outdoor lifestyle. And these people would freak out that I murdered innocent animals. I mean, the culture war started when the insanity of animal rights came to be. And then they find out that I carried a gun and that I believed in self-defense. And these hippies were aghast. I mean, they just began.
How dare you carry a gun when every free man in history carried a weapon?
So I was being attacked and condemned and ostracized for what can only be described as the perfect human responsibility of defending one's life and balancing the herds and eating venison. Those two elements, the hunting lifestyle and the Second Amendment, were the tip of the culture war spear when it started. Because the hippies couldn't believe that I would kill an innocent animal.
And by the way, even folks that, you know, love you for decades and don't know the lore of Ted Nugent, I know a lot of it, and I don't mean to be kissing your butter, but it is cool to see how long ago you were basically doing what I've been doing for 20 years, 40, 50 years ago. It's just crazy, Ted.
It really was, and it struck me. You know, I pursed my lips and furrowed my brow, and I went, wait a minute. So you think I'm an idiot for not snorting cocaine and smoking dope, but that I should be jailed for and a Second Amendment participant. Really, that's the premise of your hate for me. So the Saul Alinsky machine work started running amok, and they would call me a racist and a homophobe and a draft dodger and an anti-Semite, you know, all the knee-jerk dishonesty from the left if they can't debate you. And of course, that the left cannot debate me because I'll eat their family tree and spit sawdust like I did on Texas Public Television and to our friend Pierce Morgan. And so they would immediately begin to attack me personally and claim that I can't play guitar and that I'm a homophobe when I actually am none of the things that they claim I am. So I take that as a badge of honor. But what you're seeing at Fox, what you're seeing from the unbelievable power of the Clinton machinery, these people can meet with Loretta Lynch, and she can actually violate her oath to the Constitution and edit the tapes from the Orlando shooting 911 calls without a flinch, without any sense of accountability, knowing she's immune from prosecution because the president hired her based on the color of her skin, not the content of her character. And that statement I just made alone will so infuriate the leftist, America-hating media and academia and the government punks and thugs that hate Ted Nugent and hate Alex Jones and hate the Constitution, hate freedom, hate the Pledge of Allegiance. They hate everything good about people, everything good about them. I could not be more proud.
And by the way, Ted Nugent, you're saying all this. It's just pure veritas. It's just, I think you're the only guest we have on where it's just all like, just like absolute veritas. It's just every word is absolutely totally true. They have inverted reality. They're the most anti-liberal people. I think of liberal as Thomas Jefferson, more freedom, lower taxes, you know, every person a right to defend themselves, maximum individual liberty. That's liberal. These people aren't liberal. I think it's time to really call them what they are. Just a bunch of scum and criminals and losers that want to control reality and run our lives. And I tell you, more and more of the grassroots so-called leftists are getting off the plantation. I really see that happening. But in your gut, what else are you really concerned about? Obviously, you know, communists, Black Lives Matter, Obama refusing to repudiate them, saying, you know, the cops need to reform themselves, implying the death of police is a good thing. I mean, I don't understand the disconnect. How does Obama think he's going to get away with starting the civil war in the country? Or do I have a blind spot? I mean, does he have a chance? What's he doing?
I don't think he has a chance. We see these isolated events of outrageous demonicy by the sniper in Dallas and the murderer in Baton Rouge. Right after those horrific events attacking the heroes of law enforcement, Alex, I was with the Dallas Police Department. I happen to have trained with some of these guys, and I work with these guys. And just last night, we were in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and I met with a bunch of the heroes of law enforcement there. But more importantly than those law enforcement warriors are the enormous crowds, the armies of we the people who stand with law and order and law enforcement. So I don't believe that even as a dishonest, America-hating, anti-constitutionalist that we have as the commander-in-chief, I don't believe that even the power that he has with all his communist buddies like Van Jones and Loretta Lynch and Valerie Jarrett, I don't think they're going to overwhelm we the people. It got close there for a while because of the apathy and the allowing of the dumbing down of America. But I hang with people every day, Alex. I have meetings every day with people with charities, children's charities, military charities, conservation charities, working hard, playing hard Americans that sacrifice and take risks.
And by the way, statistics show, that's right, major studies in Canada and the UK show that conservatives and libertarians worldwide and Christians and patriots give six times more money than liberals and just do so much more good stuff. And that the left, again, is six times more likely to rob. I mean, the left are just criminals.
There's no question about it. But let me give you an example. I know a lot of people would just think that this is an isolated example, but I get it all the time. And if I was on the radio with you every day, I could give you a dozen examples like this every day where an ultra-liberal radio guy, a disc jockey who I've been working with for about 40-plus years, we recently did an interview in Detroit, and during the interview he said, this is going to be very difficult for me, Ted, but I want to publicly state live on the air my apology to you. Because I always ridiculed you and made fun of you and condemned you for your politics going back to the 60s and 70s and 80s. And I just want to publicly state that I was wrong and you were right. Now that I have woke up, now that I have educated myself to what is going on in our government and so much of the media and academia, those are that's the triad of power abuse and criminality, government, media, and academia. He apologized to me, and he's a liberal guy, Alex.
That's amazing. Stay there. Final segment with Ted Nugent. I just realized something. Ted Nugent's like the original InfoWarrior of the last century. By the way, this is my favorite guitar riff of all time, hands down. There is no debating it. Just the ass kicking or kissing contest just continues. But it's just true, though. I mean, Ted Nugent is that good. He's been fighting the culture war for almost 50 years. That's hard to believe, isn't it? And the guy doesn't look like he's 55. He has been putting out some of the most savage music in the world for decade after decade. And I just love it when I'm driving down the road and hear his music, or I see a car commercial or a new hot movie coming out and it's Ted Nugent music. I mean, you know, and I've got myself a radio and TV show and a big crew. I mean, I got a wrecking crew. I got a rock and roll band too. And so we're all in this fight, kicking globalist commie ass. Ted Nugent, it is so awesome, man. You're right. We are winning. We are turning the tide, but it's going to get rough, my friend.
Well, let me tell you, every night when I play Stranglehold, the teeth and eyeballs that fill the audience is so inspiring. But let me tell you, since that song came out in 1975, I literally have gotten thousands of correspondence from military heroes, from Delta Force and the Army Rangers and the Green Berets and all the special ops. These guys use the song Stranglehold to gear up to go into battle. And they tell me that whenever they listen to my music before they go into battle, they kill more bad guys. Now, is there a better testimony to meaningful music than that?
Well, I mean, it's like Beethoven, but rock. The way it just builds, and it's a perfect song. It's a perfect song.
Well, you should see it from where I see it every night. I mean, it's just unbelievable.
How did you come up? I mean, and you've come up with so much incredible stuff, but how did you come up with that?
Well, first of all, I was raised in a hunting lifestyle, so that aim small, miss small ballistic ballet that you have to adhere to be a good deer hunter and to compete with my dad and my brothers at the firing range, I'm going to tell you there's something about sight acquisition, breathing, and trigger squeeze that actually applies to guitar playing if you do it right. So every time I pick up, I play a Gibson Birdland, and this hand-carved archtop jazz guitar made by American craftsmen in Kalamazoo, Michigan. It is the embodiment of what God wanted wood to be used for, and it has such a resonance, such a tapestry, such an unlimited topography of sounds and tones and voices that it feeds back and it makes these noises, and it forces you to hold it and cradle it and touch it in a certain way. And because I was raised by these black gods of thunder, the Howlin' Wolf and the Muddy Waters, and I was born in the shadow of Detroit's Motown funk brother gods of thunder, that all manifests itself in the way that I play guitar. And so that lick, it embodies so much of the human spirit of defiance, and not just the sexuality that is apparent to the rhythm and the grind of the rhythm section, but the volatility of the lyric. Here I come again now, baby.
But it does raise confidence. I'm sorry to interrupt. It does raise your confidence.
Well, I tell you, there's only one thing more dangerous than a sow grizzly with cubs, and that's Ted Nugent with more confidence. And since I play that song every night, I do believe that the founding fathers wanted everybody to be like me. That's what I believe.
Well, Ted, again, I think what you're saying here today is America's finding its spirit again, isn't it?
It really is. I got to tell you, Alex, you travel, you're a gregarious guy, you hang with working hard, playing hard Americans, and I do every day. I'm in Naples, Florida today, and I'll be hanging out with 20 people tonight at the concert in Jacksonville, and tomorrow in Melbourne, and Pompano, and up in Clearwater, and Atlanta, and Mobile, and Bossier City, and Illinois. Every night I hang with people in the asset column. People who sacrifice so they're in the asset column.
It's amazing. Five more minutes, Ted Nugent. We're back in 70 seconds. TedNugent.com. I'm Alex Jones, live from the RNC, Infowars.com. Back in 70 seconds with 5 more minutes with Ted Nugent. As much as I like Junior Brown on the steel guitar, I like Ted Nugent more, but I tell you, it's hard to just to hear the human soul coming out, the individualism of these guitar players. I mean, I think the guitar, more than anything, really brings out the human soul. That's a whole another, you know, entertainment radio show, but I think it's celebrating the fact that we're independent, we're individuals, and the way the left loves ugliness, the way they love poverty, the way they love, you know, quite frankly, Ted, I'm not just saying this. I think at the end of the day, the left really are just Satanists. What do you think?
Honest, what Ben Carson said last night and is being attacked for, Saul Alinsky did write the Bible for the left. It's literally what Valerie Jarrett genuflects to every time she writes words for Barack Obama. Barack Obama has been caught lying over and over again his entire life. Valerie Jarrett makes sure that his speeches are full of lies that feel good and will continue to enslave the sheep on the left. But that book, Rules for Radicals, the first page, Alex, it was dedicated to Satan, the great manipulator. And that's the author and the book that Hillary Clinton mentored under when she wrote her law degree thesis on Solomon's
Institute. Oh, yeah, she wrote him love letters, like letters back and forth with him, just totally sick.
So no, the media does not expose this important information, and they don't condemn the lies of Hillary and Loretta Lynch and Valerie Jarrett and Barack Obama and Van Jones and all their acorn scam artists and their Media Matters, MoveOn.org, Huffington Post, Southern Poverty Law Center scam artists and liars. So logically speaking, those of us in the asset column, we have to live by logic and common sense and practical, pragmatic, utilitarian accountability. You cannot find accountability in the government, in the media, or in academia. It's all a scam. So we're challenged to why. We can't answer the question why in a logical way. So we just have to admit what you asked about demonicy, about Satanism. That's the only answer. They hate success. They hate excellence. They hate productivity. They hate everything in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. So I couldn't be more proud. I don't want those punks to like me. I want them to be afraid of me.
Absolutely.
I want them to hate me. I want them to lie about me. I am so proud that the enemies of America hate Ted Nugent. I can hardly stand myself.
Well, you know, you are totally on target. It's a badge of honor to have these culture-destroying scum hate us, and it is a badge of honor. But family to them says, man, hundreds of newspapers attacked you this week. How are you taking it? And I'm like, the enemy newspapers that literally are undermining this country and promoting cop killing and all the rest of this crazy crap, they hate me? Thank God. If they like me, I've got a serious, serious problem. TedNugent.com, I mean, you've got so many millions of followers on Facebook, and there's so many other big websites. Where are the best places for people to stay in contact on a daily basis with everything Ted Nugent?
Well, I'll tell you, Alex, I am humbled at the tens of millions every day on my Facebook. I have a Ted Nugent official Facebook, and people come from all around the world to celebrate the self-evident truth of the American dream, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the Declaration of Independence. I'm telling you, it is not a Ted Nugent thing. It is a people honesty thing. So my Facebook, I get on numerous times every day, and I have great communications about rock and roll and about politics and about quality of life and about logic and about goodwill and decency. So I am encouraged every day that more and more people are waking up to the scourge of what Obama represents, the scourge that the media represents. And I couldn't be more confident or proud right now.
Well, Ted, thank you so much for your time. I know we're both Central Texans, and so hopefully sometime I can go out hunting with you. That's always been something I wanted to do. But thank you for your time. Thank you for your energy. And I want to thank my audience for, you know, what they do, magnifying what InfoWars is up to, but also what you're doing, because now is the time to push it to the hilt, because the enemy is going to pull a lot of scams. Ted Nugent, thank you so much, sir.
Godspeed, Alex. You're on my blood, brother.
I am in heaven right now at the RNC. We got a big interview today with Nigel Farage. It's going to come out tonight. We just had Ted Nugent on. We just had Roger Stone in studio with us with huge positive news. We got Dinesh D'Souza of the Reagan administration, who was a speechwriter, headed up departments, you name it, who is a political prisoner, which to me is a great, you know, badge of honor, like Alexander Solzhenitsyn. I mean, literally set up. He's now has made the film Hillary's America that I got in late, didn't get to go see it Sunday when it premiered. And my crew that saw it said it is so hardcore. 2016 was the second biggest grossing documentary in U.S. history, or I guess world history, and really did wake a lot of people up. But I thought it wasn't hardcore enough. It was totally engrossing, and I love the film, but he's a nice guy. Well, they came after him for that because they're scared of him. Well, now he's made a film that is hardcore. And because I talked to my crew and their filmmakers, and they said, this thing, if people see this, it's over for Hillary. Let me explain how this works, though. They have theaters, and they've pulled these scams in movies I've been in where they try to not show them. They don't advertise them. They don't want, when films first go out, they don't want them to be successful because then they get picked up by the theaters. I know folks understand that. But if you want to strike a blow at Hillary Clinton, I'm going to say this out of the gates before we go. This guy's sitting there listening to me rant. But I'm sorry. I mean, I'm going to war against Hillary. I know you are, too. I mean, against this tyrant. You've got to take 10 of your friends. Be aggressive. I want you to take your Rotary Club. I want you to take your neighbors. I want you to take your parents. I want you to take your kids. I want you to take your whole office to this, especially brainwashed leftists, who I don't even call liberals. These are anti-liberal authoritarians masquerading with camouflage as liberals. Thomas Jefferson was a liberal. These are no liberals. Dinesh D'Souza, to me, is a classical liberal. That you'd call that a paleoconservative. These terms mean nothing. They've scrambled everything. They've inverted reality. I talked to Ted Nugent. I would liken them to Satanists. I mean, you know, Saul Alinsky's their god. He pledged his book to Lucifer. And Hillary is trying to invert reality. She was pen pals with this guy. So this is what we're dealing with. I mean, like communists yesterday attacking me and screaming racist. I mean, I've never done anything racist. You know, my sister's adopted from South Korea. You know, I grew up in Dallas, Texas. Half my friends are black. But this is how they operate, ladies and gentlemen. This is how they get their agenda through. So you need to go see the film. You need to find out where it is on their website. You need to go religiously. Because if this film goes viral, like 2016, this, I believe, and I'm sure of it, just like I told you, buy the Hillary for prison shirts, and it would become a meme, number one meme on the internet in the last 3 weeks, four different times now. It's freaking everyone out that 15, 20%, sometimes 30% of people are wearing them here at the RNC. They're chanting it on the floor. They can't stop the signal. The Clinton rape's coming out. We can break through their Berlin Wall. We're the people. But I'm telling you, this weapon forged in Vulcan smithy down under the volcano is the black arrow that'll take down smog. So I'm mixing two different metaphors there. You absolutely must go see Hillary's America, or you're putting Hillary Clinton in office. This guy has been persecuted and thrown in prison. Now, I'm done ranting, but I tell you, you're a hero to my family, my children. I can tell you, I'm right up there in the same firing line with you. You've been walking point for so long. Dinesh D'Souza, we admire you, sir. And you're obviously only stronger after what you've gone through, sir.
Yeah, I think this experience, Alex, of having just been locked up by the Obama administration in the wake of a technical violation of the campaign finance laws, when I began to see that no American has ever gone to prison for doing what I did, and then when I see what Hillary gets away with, I mean, it's clear to me that we have now lawlessness at the highest levels of our society. And it kind of changes the rules of American politics, because the way I came of age in the Reagan era, and I was kind of living in the pointy-headed intellectual world at think tanks, I kind of got the idea American politics is a gentleman's fight between two groups of people. We agree on our goals, we disagree on means. We're both trying to get to the same place, but we may argue about how to get there. It's clear to me now that we have, in the Democratic Party, a gang, the Hillary gang, and preceded by the Obama gang. And these people are gangsters, and they operate in a gangsterish way. And they want to deploy the organs of government against their critics and against the people who oppose them. And so far from cowering and hiding, I think we need to go sling blade on these guys, absolutely open up every front. The movie is a shift of career for me, going from books, which have important but have a limited reach, to movies where you try to reach millions of people. This will make us a threat, but on the other hand, at the end of the day, we can reach more people, we can change more minds. The FBI won't indict Hillary, but our movie does it.
That's right. I can't wait to see it. I'm so angry. How do people go see it? Obviously, they go to the website. It's so critical up front to make it a huge hit so it gets put on thousands of screens and dominates.
It's a secret of Hollywood that the fate of a movie depends a lot on the opening weekend.
That's right.
That if it does well, it blows out to more theaters. And so our website is HillarysAmericaTheMovie.com. HillarysAmericaTheMovie.com. And you can watch a trailer and you can put in your zip code and it's going to tell you where you can see the movie near you. So do that. Please try to see it this weekend. Some people say, I'll wait a month. I'll see it in DVD. No. If you want to put fuel in.
Go deal with the crowds. You want the crowds. This is stomping on Hillary. When you're crushing in there and you're got someone sitting next to you, that means we're winning.
The film, we premiered it here at the RNC. We had 2,000 people, delegates. People went nuts. I mean, you had people crying, people applauding wildly. I think people got the sense that this is a film that delivers the punch that we often don't deliver. You know, too often Republicans go in the fetal position. They take a beating from the Democrats. And they just rely on other people to do our work. Oh, we're waiting for Comey to indict, so he'll do our work for us. No, he's not going to do our work for us. We have to do our work for us.
That's right. Speaking of media being more important than ever and persecution, I knew about this a year ago, but I confirmed it a few weeks ago, and I confirmed it with Roger Stone and others, and he's been a consultant at Fox, but I've talked to high-level folks at Fox. There is a coup there with this made-up sexual harassment stuff by you know, some of these women that, you know, he hugged them or whatever, you know, 6 years ago or whatever, to bring down Fox, and that the liberal Murdoch children are in a deal with Hillary. And I know from three different people, they're told, do not mention Bill Clinton and his stuff with women, or you're fired. Well, Hannity's still done it. Now 30 hosts are now up to 30 threatening to leave and go with Ailes. But that, aside from Fox, it shows the climate where the Clintons are running coups at Fox right now to try to stop, guaranteed, your film getting out, you know, a whole laundry list of stuff. This is crazy, folks. This shows that they're battling to try to maintain control of the country. We're just peacefully here trying to vote and get our nation back. They're trying to start civil wars and cop killing and everything else you can imagine. I mean, this is crazy.
I think it's worse than Obama with these guys, because with Obama, his end goal was ideological. Now, Obama...
Just lower America. Just...
Yeah. Now, but Obama's willing to be gangsterish in the way he gets about it. So he's willing to, you know, he'll ignore the immigration laws, or he'll selectively enforce the Obamacare.
He'll turn the IRS loose on 10,000 churches.
Yeah, or he'll ignore the regulations that say that welfare reform, you have to do this and this to qualify. But with Hillary, I think it's gangsterism through and through. I mean, I think that's who she is. That's her MO. And if I had to say what she wants to be, she kind of wants to be the mob boss of America, the Al Capone of America. And Al Capone wanted to run Chicago like he owned the city, right? He had access to the city contracts. He told people what to do. You're against him. Snuff that guy out. And he wanted to go in the stadium and have the whole crowd shout, Big Al, Big Al, Big Al. So this is what this woman, Hillary, wants. She has these sort of cultic ambitions for America, unless the American people say differently.
You're absolutely right. And it's coming down to a head. This film, describe the film. Let's go through this, because the idea for the film... I mean, let's walk through why this film's so special.
Well, when we started out the film, we actually had an immediate problem, and that is that in 2012, Obama was an interesting guy. People were, like, fascinated by him. Who the heck is this fellow? He came out of nowhere. Not a lot is known about him. What motivates him? Where is he coming from? So you could make a movie about Obama. I don't believe you can make an interesting movie just about Hillary, because if I were to put... I mean, Hillary's been around. We know who she is. We know she's a crook. We know she's a pathological liar. So if you made a movie and put Hillary's face on there for 90 minutes, I believe that my audience would want to blow its brains out.
I agree. I can't look at her.
Yeah. You can't stand it. So you have to make a different kind of movie. And so we sat back and said, look, the way to make this movie is to see Hillary as part of a movement. She's part of a gang. Her gang is the progressive gang. It's the Democratic gang. Now, interestingly, this gang has been up to really bad stuff for a long time. A lot of Republicans don't know this. Even Reagan didn't know it. Reagan would go, I didn't leave the Democratic Party. The Democratic Party left me. You got the idea. The Democrats are really good guys until like 15 minutes ago. And then with the McGovern campaign or something, they went off the rails. But I think when you dig into it, going all the way back to the days of slavery and segregation, eugenics in the early 20th century, forcibly sterilizing people.
They quarterbacked every damn nightmare there is. And the Republicans have been really good.
And the genius of the Democrats is, having done that, they then figured out, let's take all of what we did and blame it on the South. Let's take all of what we did and blame it on America. Let's even blame it on the Republicans who tried to stop us from doing it.
And then they got Hollywood on the game, bashing the South. It's just a sick, it's dividing America.
If you have the media, if you have Hollywood, and if you have academia, you have the three biggest megaphones in the country. It's very hard for anyone to contradict you when you control all three. And so that's why these people have been getting away with it. And they've been conning young people and fooling African Americans. So our movie in that sense...
Well, Hillary's behind the scenes saying, yeah, we got to make them heel like dogs. You know, they're predators. While they're putting all the black males in jail for no reason to turn them into predators in a college of crime, which they full well know. And then they go give speeches about the colleges of crime when they're the ones that wrote the GI Bill to put everybody in prison.
So we've been having all this urban unrest. And in the film, we have this theme. We call it the urban plantation. So the old plantations were rural, right? And if you think about the old plantations, what did you have? You had ramshackle dwellings. You had the family structure all broken up, illegitimacy widespread. You had everybody got a meager living. You got sick, they called a doctor. But on the other hand, no opportunity. No one gets ahead. Hopelessness, despair, nihilism. Well, hey, Fast forward 150 years, if you and I were to walk in inner city Oakland, Detroit, Chicago, St. Louis, what do we see? Ramshackle dwellings, family structure all broken down. Everybody gets a meager living here, some food stamps. But on the other hand, no opportunity, no one gets properly educated, no hope, no ladder to climb up. So it's chilling to see the way the Democrats who ran the old plantations have created new plantations to do pretty much the same thing.
And you have absolutely documented it in the new film. I mean, my crew wrote notes for me of the film. I have like 8 pages of them. I've got one of the pages here. And so I've actually kind of not seen the film, but I've heard about it. I'm salivating. And you need to go. And I'm not just salivating to see this great filmmaker's work, the writer. I know this is a weapon of truth that this dragon needs to have thrust into her politically. How do you handle Fox News? Oh, you just go in and take it over. Turn it into the, you know, CNN light. That's what's happening. That shows you this country is on the knife's edge. They're activating communist and radical groups that attacked me yesterday. They are running around calling for more cops to be killed. They want a civil war. I've never seen a more naked exercise of open tyranny in my lifetime. And I look back on American history. There's not a lot of examples of this. Dinesh D'Souza, filmmaker, here in studio with us. Hillary's America. Everybody needs to go to the website. We're going to put it on screen for TV viewers. You need to go there. You need to go see the film, because when you go the first opening week, I'd say it's like the equivalent of getting thousands of people to go later. I mean, you're going to reach thousands of people by putting it in theaters where folks going to the theater just see it up there and have an opportunity to go, hey, I want to see that. That's why his film was the second biggest documentary in history. This is a short segment, long segment coming up. We're going to take some calls, Dinesh. But Dinesh, what scares me is I don't need to have any exaggeration or hyperbole to make this show, you know, interesting. I am so freaked out by the climate. I can't believe there's a coup going on at Fox. There's all these attacks on free speech. The president, when cops get killed, says we need to reform the police. Hillary says white folks better listen up. How do we get an elite like this? They run the country. Why do they want to cause a civil war and run in the ground? Why do they want to burn everything down? What is their problem? What makes them tick?
Well, I think with the Clintons, what makes them tick is a insatiable appetite for money and power. Now, Bill is different than Hillary. Bill's appetites are smaller. In other words, with Bill, you put him in a big room, you give him the biggest meal, you tell him he's the greatest guy, you put a long line of women outside, and Bill's happy. That's like the circumference of his appetites. But Hillary has a kind of a tyrannical streak in which she wants to know what you and I are having for dinner. In other words, she's not happy if she's not running things, telling people what to do, telling corporations what to do. That guy's against me. Okay, let's get rid of him. Let's move him off stage. This is a different kettle of fish.
Yeah, she has her people call a major comedy club in L.A. and actually the campaign threaten them. You will not let people make fun of me anymore.
Yeah, it's a very, I mean, if you follow her life from a young age, this is a very twisted individual.
Sounds like a nightmare to want to know what everybody's doing. Well, I barely run my own life. What's her problem?
Just look at the way she's handled, Bill. I think Hillary comes at a young age and she sees Bill and she sees this attractive guy and she sees he's very gregarious and he has this kind of political magnetism. And she goes, he has it, I don't have it. So if I want to get somewhere, I actually need him. But this is a problem, because even if I get him, 15 minutes later, he's going to go off with somebody else. So how do I prevent that permanently? I need to find out what his weakness is. And what's his weakness? Well, he's kind of a sex addict, and he can cross the line and do whatever he wants with women, and that's probably going to get him locked up. And he probably knows that. So I'll go to him, and I'll figure out a thing, and I'll basically say, Bill, listen, you need me, because I'm your fixer. I'll cover it up for you.
I'm your cover person.
Yeah. And so
that is what she does. That's
my point is she's not the sort of betrayed housewife who's like, we feel sorry for poor Hillary. She's had this horrible husband. No, she's been his enabler since day one. She's known about this from the very beginning.
She's already been president for 8 years.
Yeah. So this gives you just a little window into the character of the kind of person who would frame their life this way.
An archetypal villain.
And somebody who would be so power hungry that you'd be settling for a lot of the most kind of sick personal arrangements in order to kind of get what you want.
Well, that's the Russians admit they're scared of, and they never talk like that.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And I guess if I were Putin, I would be too.
I mean, because she's dangerous. She might, I mean, like you said, she's very vindictive, but beat Bill up. That's come out, Secret Service. I mean, this is a monster.
We don't have the full handle on her, and in this film, we try to trace episodes of her life. We focus on one incident, very telling in the film, where she is assigned to defend a guy who is who raped a 12-year-old kid, right? And what does Hillary do? She blames the victim. She goes after the 12-year-old because the 12-year-old is fantasizing. The 12-year-old is young people are known to make stuff up, and the prosecution has lethal evidence. I mean, they have incriminating evidence, and what Hillary does is she goes after that evidence, discredits it, and then, this is the key, laughs about it. In other words, it's one thing to say, look, the guy needs a defense, everyone needs a lawyer.
She got off on the evil being protected. She didn't get a stomachache to go, that's my job. She enjoyed it.
Yeah, and the good thing is we don't just say this. We don't make accusations of this movie. We play audio tape. So you listen to Hillary.
Let's come back and talk about this because this story is important. This hasn't gotten out there. This is one of the things I've been told is banned on Fox, CNN, all of it, is the rape stuff and this story about her you know, helping this rapist get off. So this is really important. Dinesh D'Souza is here with us. They do not want you to be hearing this. Make no mistake. They don't want the aircraft, the Hillary for prison flying around. They got those banned. They want to shut us up. We're not shutting up. Stay with us. Whether likes it or not, we're going to shut down talk radio. We're going to install Hillary. It's all going to happen. Get ready. And then now here we are like 9-10 months later. It's happening. There's a coup at Fox. That means they're coming for us next. And that is such a surreal feeling to be sitting next to a political prisoner who was thrown in prison for 9 months, literally because they didn't fill out a piece of paperwork when he got 4 or 5 of his friends to donate money to a campaign running against for Hillary's old Senate seat. I mean, she's taking money from third world dictators, $100 million from Gulf states that throw gays off buildings and women can't drive cars and they're like chained up like dogs. And she's saying that Trump's a chauvinist pig over here. I mean, this is the inversion of reality. We're going back to Dinesh D'Souza here in a moment. We're going to open the phones up too for a few questions if you have them for Dinesh D'Souza. 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. But before I go any further, well, that's first-time callers today, by the way, 800-259-9231. InfoWars is a platform, the globalists know this, to promote Americana. And I skip network breaks. I don't plug every segment like other hosts. I haven't hardly plugged a day except for 30 seconds because I'm so on fire fighting tyrants. Bottom line, you fund my operation. I will take it to the enemy, and I've shown I'll do that, and I will put, this year I'm putting everything in. Okay, I am all, our reserves, everything, okay? Because I know there's no future. This is a critical time. I'm not going to take the field against this enemy and not go 110%. We have the best vitamins and minerals and supplements that anybody's got. That's why third-party sites give us 5 stars, just because I went out and hired the top 3 companies in the country to make our proprietary products. Some of them are private labeled as well. I mean, our colloidal silver, you know, instead of $25, is $19. The same stuff they sell at Whole Foods. It's the highest quality, safest, you know, according to the government and the rest of it. That's an example. It's just a topical deal, you know, antibiotic and other stuff doesn't work. That's an example. But DNA Force, that sale's ending. Whether it's a Hillary for Prison shirt, books, films, thousands of great items, solar power generators for your house, high-quality storable foods, all of it, thousands of items that are available at InfoWarsStore.com are by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. And it's this broadcast that funds not just my operation, but helps boost so many other operations against the globalist and against tyrants and leftists and all these other criminal institutions like the nefarious activities of George Soros. So I'm kind of distracted with a helicopter flying outside the window. But it's very, very important that folks realize that when somebody like Roger Stone or myself are out of energy, I take a Brain Force. And it's natural compounds. Some of them are prescription in Europe that are known to safely boost your energy, but clear thinking, not a bunch of caffeine. There is some green tea in it. Brain Force, available at InfoWarsStore.com as well, or InfoWarsLife.com, takes you directly to the nutraceuticals. Maybe Buckley, we should probably aim at that helicopter for folks out there if we can. We've got a limited crew here. Because we actually have the folks that run InfoWars normally in the back room are actually running the cameras today because we've got everybody deployed out with the communists burning flags and Black Lives Matter people running around calling for violence and interviewing Nigel Farage and so much more. And all that's going to be on the Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock Central, InfoWars.com/show for details and affiliates and more. So be sure and check that out. But just know, and I think everybody knows this, I want to thank the listeners. You're just as important as I am or any of the crew at InfoWars when you buy the products, when you support us. So again, we're going to go ahead and punch that up. You can see the helicopter out there. It's a little bit blown out, but the helicopter right outside the window. And obviously something interesting is going on. We're right above the Quicken Loans Center, about 300 yards away, right here at the entrance. We also have passes to be anywhere we want to inside. We've had our crew in there, but so much more is happening outside. I will be in there doing live feeds tonight, so look for all of that at InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. But here's the bottom line. I'm almost mad at myself calmly sitting here right now just talking about coups at Fox News and attempts to shut down free speech and government in different documents and in public schools banning the words mother and father. I mean, sometimes I think it's like I woke up in a nightmare Alice in Wonderland. But just thank you for the support and be sure and shop with the good guys so that we can fund our operation and be truly independent. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. Now, going back to Dinesh D'Souza, who's with us till the end of the hour, we're going to take a few phone calls. Dinesh, you've got the floor here. Run with it. You've just been laying out so much truth here. Your new film, Hillary's America, it's critical that everyone go and that everyone see it as it opens this coming weekend. Your last film really crippled them, but this one's even more hardcore. This could be the political death blow of everything going on out there, everything in the resistance. I see this as probably undoubtedly the most powerful truth bomb in the information peaceful war we're in against these tyrants out there. How do we make sure it hits its target?
Our website is HillarysAmericaTheMovie.com. And if you go there, you should watch the trailer, share it, and also put in your zip code. It'll tell you where the movie's playing near you. The reason the movie is powerful, it's a really good movie, but more importantly, it tells its story as a detective story. It's a narrative. It's a thriller. Now, since Hillary is the topic of it, we do veer into the horror genre. Couldn't avoid that. So there's a little bit of that in the movie, too. But the point is this. People always come to me and say, Dinesh, make a movie about Obamacare. Dinesh, make a movie about immigration. But people don't go to movies to get messaging. They don't go to movies even to be educated. They go to movies to be entertained. And we know that. So we make actually a very entertaining movie, which leaves you not only intellectually empowered, but emotionally moved and ready to act.
And it is hard. So you got interrupted at the break getting into her defending sexual predators. So let's talk about the story.
You know what's so creepy about it is this is Hillary in a little younger age. And of course, Hillary is such a chameleon that when she's narrating the story, it's her own voice. Remember, some of the most powerful passages in 2016 were Obama talking in his own voice. And the reason we had his own voice is that he read his own book, Dreams of My Father, from my father in audiobooks. So we could play sections where Obama's telling the story. Well, who can disagree? This is Obama talking about his own mind and his own life. And here we have Hillary in her own voice. Now, she's got the fake Southern accent. And she's kind of putting on, well, and she's telling the story about this guy who did a rape. Except when you listen to her tone, it is so frigid cold. And then she talks about, she goes, I got this guy to take a lie detector test, a polygraph test, which he passed. And then she adds, which forever destroyed my faith in polygraphs. And then she laughs, ha, 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 you know, our famous cackle. And you actually begin to hear, in a way, this is the first time you say, well, that's actually the voice of evil. That's actually someone who is happy that this guy beat the rape thing and that she got him off. And she thinks it's actually funny.
Wow.
That the guy who did it was able to lie and get out of it.
And for me, it's knowing about how psychopaths and sociopaths are. They have this real self, but everything else is like fake to manipulate. When she goes to California and speaks to a Latino group, she puts on this fake Latino voice. When she goes to Kentucky, she goes, how you doing there, boy? Like she's, you know, Grandma Clampett getting some possum grits for you. Hanger. I mean, it's like, I wouldn't hang around with anybody that when they got around different groups, talked a different way. I mean, it is bizarre to show that that's what psychopaths do. And I think she's a psychopath. I think she's a full-blown psychopath, is that they do feel this need to just put on these fake acts. It's very creepy. What do you think?
I think so. And I think she might even have gotten some of this from Bill, because Bill is the master of it. And we have actually, you know, people have heard, I did not have sex with that woman. But what they actually haven't heard is, if you go back and play the old tapes where Bill was and Hillary were both confronted with all this stuff, and the kind of silky nonsense that they put out there. At one point, I think it was Steve Croft says to the Clintons, well, you know, I think Americans can kind of accept that you guys, whatever your problems, you've worked it out, you've made some kind of arrangement. And then Bill jumps in and he goes, arrangement? We don't have an arrangement. we love each other. We have a marriage.
Yeah.
It's totally different.
Yeah, she's not, you know, banging three chicks a day like me, too. I mean, you know.
I mean, so I think what you do is, you know, what I try to do with these movies, at the end of the day, it's about peering into their soul. And with the Obama movie, I tried to get Obama. At the end of the day, it's not just about his policies. Yesterday,
he's out to bring America down.
Yeah, I mean, yesterday, Christie stood up and recited the indictment against Hillary. Boom, point one, point two, point three. And this is the Republican thing. You make a kind of legal indictment. But it's even more powerful if you can pull people into a narrative where they can understand Hillary as a person. They kind of get her, and then they realize what we're dealing with.
I agree. Well, that's why Megyn Kelly, I don't want to get off on a jag. I've watched her. I see her on that sinister power trip. It's that Jezebelian energy. And, you know, Roger Ailes, who made her who she is, to see her say he hugged me once too hard and I want him taken out. And I know, because I have the inside baseball, it is from the Clintons. There are talking points. People are being threatened. I've talked to the host. And it's like, wow, she really is an agent of the Clintons and all that stuff with Trump. And it's like seeing her join with evil. Now, this is 1,000 times worse with Hillary, obviously, but it's just, it's the creepiness. It's the dishonor of it. It's the sliminess that really tells you what we're dealing with is a bunch of evil people. Because I don't have the energy to run around and scheme and want to run other people's lives. I don't have the energy, and I study these evil people. They enjoy, like you said earlier, running other people's lives, knowing what you're doing, controlling you, ruining you. Just because they're quite frankly jealous of you. And they're jealous of America. They're jealous of free market. They're jealous of open free societies compared to everything else. Not saying we're perfect. And that's what you said in your first film, I think, is it's like they want to mount our head on the wall. It's like they want to say, you know, they basically kicked our butt, Dinesh. But you know what? They haven't, have they?
Well, Hillary and Bill grew up in an America where the most successful people are the creative people that come up with new stuff.
Yeah.
Someone invents the iPhone and makes people's lives better. People happily drive in their car and give him money.
They create scams.
These guys realize we can't do that, but that doesn't mean we don't have other talents. Our talents are in stirring up resentment, mobilizing it against these wealth creators. And so there's this kind of secret war in our society between productive people who create wealth, not just the entrepreneurs, the workers too, on the one hand, and on the other hand...
Well, they want the workers poor. That's why they want to bring in the population to drive down wages.
And these guys, this kind of class of people, they're powerful in academia, in the media, in Hollywood, and these community organizers, and you've got an alliance of these guys.
That's it. And I realize being around them more and more over these years, they actually know what they're doing. I always thought a lot of them were just idiots. They know that they're creeping around manipulating everyone.
They're good at what they do. I mean, Obama, look, people say Obama's an incompoop, he can't read from the teleprompter. The truth of it is Obama has moved America a lot closer to his goals. He has undone
almost destroyed it.
He has weakened us, he has undermined our economy, he's doubled our national debt. There's places in the world where nothing could happen without America's say so. And today America has almost no influence in the region. We have very little
people
influence.
People say, oh, good, we were arrogant. Yeah, but now it's the globalists running America who are all these shadowy groups you can't even do. I mean, it's 10 times worse.
It's worse.
And the communist Chinese now are, like, dictating to Hollywood what they can put out and like, spiking Savage's book. We personally have run into the communist Chinese now trying to manipulate in the U.S. on us. I mean, they have got some tentacles, my friend.
And people say, you know, what's Hillary's view of national security? What, you know, as if Hillary has a national security doctrine. Hillary has no national security doctrine. Hillary's national security doctrine is the following. The United States has a great big pile of wealth and a great big pile of power.
And she can broker the sale of it.
Yeah, let me just help myself to as much of it as I can, and everything else is a distraction. And
she's presiding over the auction.
She is, exactly, and everything else is a nuisance.
It's like an estate sale.
That's why she was like, what difference? Because the point is, to her, it's an annoyance. It's like, what? The 3 a.m. phone calls coming in over here.
And your history and your honor and beating the British. We don't want any of that. Just get rid of it.
I mean, imagine a bunch of guys robbing Fort Knox, and people come running in and tell them, oh, someone's sick over there. Is there something? You know, they're going to be like, leave us alone. We're really busy robbing Fort Knox. We don't want to be distracted with any other nonsense. That's Hillary's attitude in Benghazi.
You're right, and that's it. And they are sociopaths, psychopaths, you know, different groups, variances of those, literally.
That's their disconnect, why they think they're going to win. They literally think in the end we're going to bow. They think in the end we're going to cower. They think in the end that we're just like them. No, that's not what's going to happen. As they get worse, we're going to get more hardcore.
Now they're ordinary Americans, rank and file Democrats, and they're suspicious of the Clintons. They know something's up here, but they think the Democratic Party is the party of the little guy. The Democratic Party's protected the outsider, the immigrant, the Latino, the black guy. So they think that Democrats have this moral capital that entitles them to rule.
Well, your film explodes the myth. I mean, they're KKK.
We take the meat axe to this whole propaganda, and we
listen. I grew up in the South. I never heard racist talk until I'd be around Democrats. And Democrats are the most, and even the quote minorities that are Democrats are like race managers. They know their job.
The racism in the South was itself fomented by the Democratic Party. If you wonder, did the South just actually genetically people are more racist? No. The Democratic Party set white supremacy as its goal and fomented racism in the South for 100 years.
On record to keep white farmers down. I mean, they wrote books admitting it. They did, you know.
Their goal was also political, to establish the Democratic Party as the single party, the monolithic one-party system in the South, and they pretty much had it going for 50 years.
Or Jefferson Davis. All the rest of it, yeah.
Well, all the way through the 20th century, the South was almost monolithically Democratic. And then later they had to come up with a new scam. Once that didn't work, the Democratic Party, they do a scam. When it gets exploded, they blame it on someone else and go on to a new one. And progressivism is just the latest manifestation of the same scam in a new guise.
Dinesh D'Souza is our guest, Hillary's America. This is not hype, folks. You've seen what our Hillary for Prison memes done. You've seen all our other memes devastate the globalists, devastate this crime syndicate, devastate the Saudi Arabians and their role in 9/11. Because you are tens of millions of listeners. You're the power. I'm just here going, hey, you know, you're like Ben Grimm in Fantastic Four trying to fight a midget. I mean, just if you decide to kick its ass, you're going to. So I'm just saying, hey, you want to run them over? There they are. Go see this film. Take 10 people to it. It will blow a big, giant hole in the side of Hillary's ship. This is a big torpedo right here. Okay, that's why he already, this is a submarine. He already shot one torpedo at him, and they put him in jail to try to stop this next one.
I like that title, a torpedo.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell my film team to start calling me that from now on.
Well, no, I mean, it really
just
is
just
true.
Call me Torpedo.
Well,
because that's what we do.
Well, it's the truth, though. And what's great about this is, I mean, I bet you really are. I mean, do you feel satisfied? If people ask, are you proud, Alex, what you've done? No, I'm satisfied because, you know, I'm not a crook. I mean, people call me a big, you know, sentimental and stuff. Yeah, you know what? I do get a tear in my eye with this when they have the national anthem.
Well, it's also, you know, from a film point of view, just looking at it artistically, a lot of times Republicans are on the defensive. Oh, we didn't do that. We're not really guilty of this. No, we didn't make too much money. Oh, we earned the money we made. A really good film is a film that is on the attack from the beginning and never lets
exactly.
up.
Exactly.
And that's what this film does. It apologizes for nothing. There's nothing to apologize for.
That's like me when people call me racist. I haven't done anything. I get mad at them. I'm not going to grovel and like virtue signal.
So we just opened the artillery from the beginning. We never stop. It gets actually more devastating as we go along. Now, the Democrats are kind of like lawyers. And think of what lawyers do. Lawyers will be like, my client was nowhere to be seen on the site of the murder. Well, actually, he was, but he didn't have a gun. Well, actually, he had a gun, but he didn't kill all those people, just one guy. So every time we make an indictment, the Democrats try to creep out of it. And so we slam them at every point, taking on their defense. Until at the end, they have nothing
you
left.
You destroy them. They are truly an organization of criminals manipulating poor people. So that's why they want to make more poor people. They're in competition against prosperity because it's like oxygen in a room. It pushes them out. We'll be back with a few of your phone calls with Dinesh D'Souza. By the way, folks, Dinesh D'Souza was with us for a full hour. He loved the show, but the traffic is so bad. Stuff's so bad. And I know I said callers for him. I apologize to callers. I'll hold over the next hour and take your calls. I said it's probably safer if they just left. Because it takes now 45 minutes to go 3 miles. I mean, it is just, now that there's like checkpoints everywhere and protests are popping up and there's helicopters flying around and communists burning flags, running around foaming at the mouth and attacking people. So I just said, why don't you just go? Because they were getting nervous. He was ready to stay. But Dinesh D'Souza, man, just being with him in person, that guy's a hero. I mean, that guy literally got thrown in prison for getting four friends to give money to a campaign. I mean, I gave money to Ron Paul once, and they opened up some criminal investigation on me. It was like $2,000, and it was totally illegal. But I learned behind the scenes it happened, and then they had news articles come out about, oh, I was so horrible. I gave Ron Paul money, $2,000, totally illegal. So they can indict a ham sandwich, folks. And I tell you, They've told me they're coming after me. I mean, I've been threatened really bad. And you know what? At the end of the day, it's kind of like Dan Bongino, the Secret Service, said. They threatened even his kids and him and broke in his house and his car. And he just said on air, he said, look, you know, just let me catch you. Let me catch you in my house, okay? And, you know, at the end, you know what? You may get me. You probably will beat me. But I'm never a psychopath or a sociopath like you. I do care. And my life is so full and so strong and so big, and yours isn't. I'm not a sociopath. I'm not a psychopath. I care about people. And it's not because I'm some goody two-shoes either. It's just because, you know, I just am not a piece of filth, you know? And that's what it comes down to. You're gonna get yours, Clubless, like evil always does. You think you're invincible? I can feel the spirit of liberty rising across this planet in my gut, not just intellectually see it. Briefly, I got some really serious news. I don't even, it's really weird. Sometimes when I have really big news, I like hold off on it. It's like, people think I get up here and want to fearmonger. I want to give you bad news to be shocking. Most of the time, I've got stacks of horrible stuff that's going on, and I actually don't even want to get to it. And there's a lot of other issues to this, but let me just go ahead and get this report out in 2 minutes right now. We talked to our law enforcement sources a few hours ago, and there was a trash truck stolen in the early morning hours today. And the trash truck is missing. Obviously, most people don't even know how to drive a trash truck. And they're concerned that it could be a plan by an ISIS person or an ISIS sympathizer to run over crowds. And that's my gut to the crew. I said, I'm not worried about mass shootings. I'm worried about somebody plowing folks with a car. So we're dealing with that. Or it could obviously be loaded up with bombs or something and then driven into a barricade and detonate. People don't normally steal trash trucks. Maybe it is a prank or something, but I think it's a very serious threat. And by the way, no one's breaking that. No one else knows that. We learned this from police sources. We talked to the Secret Service about it, and they said, yeah, of course we're aware of that. And by the way, we don't want that information out. Well, I'm sorry. That information is out, and I'm just going to put it out. My gut says put it out. Whoever stole it may have done this also to just divert the police while they're planning something else. I don't think anybody knows, okay? Maybe the mafia or something or some other group just stole the trash truck. But that's not really something there's a market for, you know, selling trash trucks, because those are all run by, you know, different contractors or cities or municipalities. So you look at all the angles, a trash truck disappearing last night or this early this morning is a very, very serious issue. And we made some other phone calls, and they were like, yeah, how do you know about the trash truck? So we're going to be watching that when you get a story out at InfoWars.com. In fact, Biggs was in here earlier giving me more information. He's outside. He's on the street with the flag burners. He put a report out on it, yeah. And so we'll get this clipped out and put out his report as well. But look, if you see a trash truck and somebody trying to run people over, somebody needs to climb in that cab and take that person out. We'll be back. By the way, this whole Melania Trump thing is a total distraction. But obviously, this has been out for hours. I hadn't looked at it. That the Trump Organization, this is what Roger Stone told me yesterday. And of course, it's been confirmed now that it was one of her friends that does PR for him that took the speech that had been written by the speechwriters and basically added that part in there that was somewhat similar to what she had said. So, and they've offered their resignation, and Trump hasn't taken it. I mean... We have the president openly trying to start a civil war in the country. We have all this garbage going on, and we've got the media focusing in on this. This is how they distract things. And again, I don't know what Trump's going to do once he gets in. I mean, I hope he does the things he said he'll do, at least part of them. But I know Hillary's a master criminal, and that's why I'm opposing her. And that's what it comes down to. Who's hosting the fourth hour today? I mean, we're already into it right now, but I forgot to ask. Who's doing that? David Knight, always doing a great job. David Knight is going to be coming in. I do want to go to some of your phone calls. These calls just came in. I appreciate you holding. D'Souza's gone now, but you can basically just put out your points to the rest of the general audience. Let's talk to Jesse in Texas. You're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, how's it going, Allie?
Good, brother.
Hey, it was kind of shocking when you said about the trash truck, because I have been thinking that there is going to be some kind of event more than likely planned and at the RNC or the DNC. Probably my guess is it's going to be at the DNC against Hillary supporters or the BLM movement to get support for their side and to blame
the BBC. If a trash truck runs over a bunch of people, they won't say it's terrorism. And if it's a jihadi that does it, they won't say it's a jihadi either, because they control language, like Karl Rove said. They control reality. And so it'll just be an act of love if they kill a bunch of people, including children.
Yeah. But
they control reality, not you or I.
Yeah, no, of course. But it'll be I'm thinking it's going to happen at the DNC, but that is very strange that a trash truck, like you said, who steals a trash truck? There's no point for it.
Yeah, folks are really concerned about it, and they're looking for it all over the place, and they're going to be on the lookout for it. But if you're at the RNC and you see a trash truck, they didn't pick it up trash, better look out.
Yeah, but yeah, you guys be safe out there, and thanks for taking my call.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate that call. Let's go ahead and talk to Milton in Texas. You're on the air. Go ahead.
How you doing? I was just calling to ask, would you support a referendum for African Americans?
A referendum on what specifically?
African American exit.
An African American exit from the country? No, because you can't have in a republic a vote to expel people. Or are you saying African Americans wanting to leave the U.S.? I know some black nationalists want their own country.
African Americans don't really need their own country just to separate like a Native American would. How they have a tribe and they American. So would you support African Americans trying to get that model?
I mean, I think if people wanted on their own to do that, that's their right to do it. I wouldn't push that and promote that. I'm going to put like 30 million people, like stick them in the middle of the desert somewhere. I understand folks like wanting to leave, say, what was happening in Europe with religious oppression or whatever, because then they wanted to be able to be Protestants or whatever. I mean, I get leaving if there was some new place to go. But if folks wanted to try to organize that and do that, that's their right to do it. I mean, I see something like New Hampshire, a free state project, where a bunch of libertarians get together on ideas, not on race, and then try to influence politics towards freedom. But that's a really good debate to have sometime. I appreciate that question. Sorry, Dinesh D'Souza wasn't here to be able to hit that. Thank you. David Nice can take over the baton. I'll probably want to take your calls. A lot of clips to play, a lot of news we haven't gotten to yet. So stay with us straight ahead. And more tonight, 7 o'clock.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this fourth hour of the Wednesday, July 20th, 2016 show. Of course, we're right in the middle of the Republican convention in Cleveland, and Alex was there live talking to Dinesh D'Souza and others. And I want to talk in this hour about another example that broke this week of political privilege. We hear a lot about white privilege. We don't hear the liberals wringing their hands over political privilege. Don't you think that's a bit of a problem? Well, we've got another example of it now with Julian Castro, the guy who is the health and urban development secretary. They've had an investigation, and like the FBI, they said, yeah, he broke the law. No foul, no penalty, nothing's going to happen to him. Okay, so we're going to talk about what's behind that. He violated the Hatch Act, but I think it has some ties with what Ruth Bader Ginsburg said about a week and a half ago when she came out in a couple of different interviews criticizing Donald Trump. It was pretty unprecedented. She was criticized for it from the Washington Post. Certainly not Trump fans there. A lot of law professors waded in on that. I think it highlights the fact that the Supreme Court has become nothing but a bunch of political activists who have been appointed for life and are totally unaccountable to the public. I think it shows the corruption of the Supreme Court. She was criticized in the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal. Many others talked about what she had to say. Eventually, she walked back those comments. But, quite frankly, and I'll make the case, I think she violated the Hatch Act as well. Not that anything will ever happen to her either. And I want to talk to one of the people on hold here, Garson in Missouri. Hang on there. I know you're a retired law professor, and I want to get your comments on this, since you're a law professor. I mean, it certainly looks to me like what she did was violate the Hatch Act. We're going to talk a little bit about the Tempest, about plagiarism. There's an interesting comment from Donald Trump. He said the media has spent more time analyzing Melania than the FBI did investigating Hillary Clinton. And that's true to some degree. You know what, though? There's no criminal penalty for plagiarism like there is for violating, knowingly violating, planning and setting up an infrastructure to violate security law regulations that we have in our government. And real quickly, before we get to the Hatch Act, I want to talk to you about the economic collapse that we see happening in Venezuela and what's going to be happening in this country as well. You know, we see the elites in Financial Times. They're talking about being concerned about the populist rage that's coming on. Of course, the Bilderberg meeting, they were concerned about the precariat, the precarious position of the proletariat, you know, those of us on the bottom. The elites are taking notice. They think they have to do something. They're concerned about the rise of Brexit, of Donald Trump, and of other issues that show that we've woken up to what they're doing to us. And of course, they're admitting that their policies are destroying our way of life. But then they keep pushing back against anything that would change any of their policies. Here's a good example of what's going to happen to us if we keep going down this road of socialism, of globalism. Look at Venezuela. They've got inflation that is now set to top 1,600% next year. This is from MarketWatch. They said inflation has been 480% this year. Next year, they expect it to be 1,640%. All right. Can you get your head around those numbers? Does that really mean anything to you? You know, we talk about billions of dollars and tens of trillions of dollars in debt. And it gets so large, it's just a statistic. You really can't grasp it. Let's talk about what that means for a gallon of milk. If a gallon of milk was $3 last year with 480% inflation, that would mean this year it'd be $14.40. Getting pretty expensive. With 1,640% inflation next year, that same $3 a gallon milk from last year, next year would cost $236. $236. That's Venezuela. You know, Margaret Thatcher said, the problem with socialism, you eventually run out of other people's money. Well, you eventually run out of all the fiat currency that you print as well. You just can't print it fast enough. And you can't earn it fast enough either. Today we had a CNN article that's up on Drudge Report. Hungry Venezuelans cry at the sight of food. We mentioned this earlier this week, how you had over 100,000 Venezuelans cross the border into Colombia trying to get food. And as this CNN story points out in the first paragraph, they say pregnant women, children, even elderly Venezuelans crossed into Colombia Sunday after the border was temporarily reopened, allowing them to buy basic foods and toiletries, things that have become rare in Venezuela. Tearful Venezuelans had gone weeks without basic food items like milk, flour, toilet paper, so forth. Okay, this is where this is headed. Where are we, however? The Financial Times is talking about the global elite need to heed the warning of populist rage. They say aspirants to power, such as Donald Trump in the U.S. and Marine Le Pen in France, offer clear, simple, and what they say, wrong solutions. What would be wrong? Well, it's nationalism, nativism, protectionism. I think that's a mischaracterization of some of what is being put out there, protectionism. But yeah, we should protect our own businesses first. We should put America first. You want to call that protectionism? Fine. It wasn't protectionism that started the Depression. It was the Federal Reserve. If you don't believe me, ask Ben Bernanke. He was the one who said, we did it. Sorry, we won't do it again, except following the same policies. They say the remedies they offer are bogus, but the illnesses are real. If governing elites continue to fail to offer convincing cures, they might soon be swept away. Let's hope so. Now, let's get this camera here on the top here. Let's look at this graph here, the big hit. Look at this bar chart here. The percent of households by country with flat or falling real market incomes from 2005 to 2012, okay? Italy, nearly 95% of the households in Italy have flat or falling real income. Second is the United States. Now, Obama tells us that we're better off in every way. Really? Really? Let me tell you something. China is better off than we are. Far better, far more stable than we are. Because the people, even though their income level, even though their wealth level is far below that of the United States, they see it increasing rapidly. I saw that when I was there, adopting my daughter. Where the problems start is when people see their income levels flattening and falling, as we do here in America. That's about 82%, they're saying here in America. Now, the UK and the Netherlands, average of 25 countries, is about 70% of people in these Western countries see their income levels flat or falling. But here in the United States, we're higher than that. We're 82%. Yet Obama tells us everything is just fine. And they go on to say, citizenship of their nations is the most valuable asset owned by most people in wealthy countries. Think about that. Do you ever think about citizenship being your asset? It is. It is. It is your most valuable asset. They resent sharing this with outsiders. I certainly do. I don't see that everyone else in the world has a right to become an American and that we have to justify denying them that right. That's an inversion of reality that has been sold to us by the Democrats. And I would say that as they're bringing in, as we see virtually every day, another terrorist act, they go in and they bomb these countries. I've got articles here about another 50 people who have been killed this last week. You've got 21 civilians killed in an ISIS stronghold in Syria. That's just one town. France 24 is talking about. U.S.-led bombings in Syria killed 77 civilians, including many children, okay? This was on Monday and Tuesday throughout Syria. So we're going in and we're killing, we started this war. We created this civil war to overthrow a political leader that we don't like. We are arming and training ISIS, which is far worse than the civilian dictator that they had. But regardless, the people that are there see the collateral damage. They see the bombs falling on civilians. What do you think they're going to think of America? Do they really care who started this? Who's right or wrong when they see their families being killed from the sky? And then what do? We have Obama bringing them to America. They start civil wars in other countries, and now they're starting a civil war in this country, bringing the people who we have been killing, bringing the people who have a righteous chip on their shoulder for the war that we've brought to their country. They're going to bring that war here. They're going to grab a garbage truck, as you just heard Alex Jones talking about. Or they're going to rent a 18-wheeler. Or they're going to grab an axe or a knife, and they're going to kill whoever is closest to them. Those are the people we're bringing here. Those are the people John Kerry is bragging to Muslims on the last day of Ramadan. Said, we're going to get 10,000 people in here from Syria, right there, where this war is the hottest. We're going to bring 10,000 people in by September the 30th. It's going to be six times, he said, the number of people we brought in last year. Have they vetted them? Can they vet them? No, of course they can't. People should not be coming into this country unless they can demonstrate to us that they are not a risk to our security. But there's no control. As a matter of fact, they do everything they can to bring these people in. Now, I'm going to begin with this, and I did lose a caller there. So I want to go through this Hatch Act circumstance. This is on Monday this broke. Remember the Castro brothers? We had one of them go with Obama to Vietnam to push the Trans-Pacific Partnership. He's a congressman. The other twin brother is the head of Housing and Urban Development, Julian Castro. He was touted as a possible running mate for Hillary Clinton. And there's a lot of talk now this week about the veep stakes on the Democrat side. On Monday, he was found guilty by the internal investigation. This is reported by the Washington Post and many other outlets, although you haven't heard much about it. They managed to release this information as the Republican convention was starting, so you wouldn't notice it. But we're going to shine a spotlight on it when we come back. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to talk about the Hatch Act conviction, without penalty, of course. I think it's something we should pay attention to in the light of Dinesh D'Souza just being on with Alex Jones, somebody who went to jail. That was unprecedented. Nobody has ever gone to jail for having donated more money to somebody than was legally allowed. It wasn't that amount, large amount of money. I think the limit is $2,500. He gave $25,000 to a college friend who was running for office was not buying influence, unlike the Clintons, and yet they sent him to jail. Always in the past, it was just a fine if you violated the law, but they sent him to jail. He truly is a political prisoner. I want to give you a couple of examples of how Hillary does it and how Hillary gets away with it. Before we do, real quickly, I just want to remind you that our special 25% off DNA Force is going to be ending tonight. We are running out of stock. We need to set some aside for auto ship. And so that will be ending tonight. And of course, DNA Force is one of our most expensive products. One of the reasons for it is because of the key ingredient, BioPQQ. That compound costs us about $30,000 per batch. It's expensive to do a batch. It is difficult to do it. Once we run out of stock, we're out for several months. So we have to set some aside for those of you who are on auto ship. But right now is a great time to stock up on it while it is 25% off, because it is such an expensive product to do. It's got a lot of ingredients in it. It's got things like digestive enzymes, CoQ10, resveratrol, other things. But the key ingredient, and you can see this is backed by 175 clinical studies, is the BioPQQ. So look that up. Do your own research. Take a look at the reviews that are on the site and take advantage of this sale before it ends. Also, don't forget, we still have Hillary for Prison t-shirts at InfoWarsStore.com. A great time to stock up on Hillary for Prison t-shirts with all of these conventions coming up, especially the one next week where there's going to, will she be going to prison or will she be going to the presidency, the big house or the White House? That's what's going to be decided in just a couple of months, and that begins this next week. Now, let's talk about Hillary. There was an article on Heat Street. And remember, as we're talking about Dinesh D'Souza, now trying to buy influence, being sent to jail for a campaign contribution, remember how the Clintons play this. Remember 20 years ago, the scandals with the Democrat National Committee and the Clintons with the Chinese people, Charlie Tree and others. Eventually, they got these guys to confess. They gave them immunity so that they would talk freely about what had happened. That is always typically used to get convictions of the higher-up criminals. In this case, no, because the higher-up criminals were the Clintons. So they just said, oh, that's what you did? Okay, thanks a lot. That's very interesting to know. They were buying influence with you. You have immunity because we gave that to you to testify, but we're not going to use that testimony to get anybody else. We just gave you immunity. Now, look at this, how the Clintons and the rest of Washington are going to get rich from the coup in Turkey. Now, of course, we've got the two political power centers. We've got Erdogan and Gulen. Erdogan is the president. They tried the military coup. Did he do a false flag military coup, as his opponents claim? Or was it something that was done by the people who were followers of Fethullah Gulen, of whom there are many in that country? He is in exile. Fethullah Gulen is a Turkish imam who is in exile in America. And, of course, we talked to Mark Hall, who did a documentary about his influence on education in this country. We have charter schools that allow taxpayer money to be given to private groups. Now, that's a problem for crony capitalism. If you don't understand how that works, you need to see the documentary. But they looked at the very worst case. What if we had some group come here and try to influence our children to try to get them to embrace the culture, the politics of a foreign country or a different religion? Okay, now they can't overtly do it with religion or they lose the money, but he has 1,000 schools worldwide, Fethullah Gulen does. Everywhere else, they're run as overt madrasas. Here, they teach people the Turkish language. You need to know that, don't you? If you're going to school in America, you should learn how to speak Turkish, not Spanish or some other foreign language, right? Turkish is what you need to know, and they send people, including a lot of local and federal officials, on junkets to Turkey. It's a very large network. They get $500 million in taxpayer money for these school networks, and they've been investigated for corruption, for bid rigging by the FBI, by many others as well. Now, they've been accused by the Turkish government of being involved in that coup. We don't know, okay? Could be either one of them. Both of them have ties to our government. Both of them, both Erdogan and Gulen, have ties to the CIA. Both of them are capable of this type of action, of trying to start a military coup or even of doing a false flag military coup. Neither of them are good guys. But how is this going to work out? We got the Podesta Group, which is connected to the Clintons, okay, registered in May to start lobbying for the Alliance for Shared Values. And as they point out in Heat Street, that comically named organization supports Fethullah Gulen, the Pennsylvania-based imam. And they have made a lot of money. That's the way the Clintons make money. They don't go to jail like Dinesh D'Souza. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Fethullah Gulen people are with the Clintons. And she, meanwhile, says that the stranglehold, this is a quote from Hillary, the stranglehold of wealthy special interests in Washington needs to end. So, you know, I guess maybe it's just American special interests that she doesn't like in Washington. But foreign governments are free to buy all the influence that they want, you know, whether it's Turkey or Saudi Arabia or whatever. Meanwhile, they said, as they point out, Heat Street, she is vacuuming up millions of dollars in donations from individuals and entities. And we know how this is going to play out if she becomes president. On the other side, we've got Republicans and Democrats making money from Erdogan. We've got the Turkish embassy in Washington getting money from the Gephardt Group that's led by former House Majority Leader Dick Gephardt, as well as also hiring Vin Weber's lobbyist group. Okay, so it's working in both ways. It just, that's how Washington has played itself out. So they go in and they create problems, and then these people try to buy influence from them. Of course, Erdogan is trying to extradite Fethullah Gulen. And as we pointed out in the interview that I had with Mark Hall on Sunday, it also has consequences for NATO, has consequences for a U.S. military base. It has consequences for the relationship that we have between us and Russia. Turkey is playing that card as well, trying to move closer to Russia, has shut down the U.S. military base. I don't know if that's been reopened or not. Certainly, there's no good side in this Turkish situation. But let's take a look. As you're looking at how this Turkish imam, who has 150 schools here in America, where they are indoctrinating about 60,000 American children, and he is buying millions of dollars of influence from Hillary Clinton, as you look at that, consider the person who had been touted as one of the strongest running mates for Hillary Clinton, Julian Castro. The Castro brothers, the twin brothers, one is a congressman, the other is now Secretary of Housing and Urban Development. Their mother was one of the founding members of the race, La Raza, the explicitly racist Hispanic group. And they were touting him as a key possible choice for running mate. We're going to look at some of the other possible choices of running mate that people are putting forward to Hillary Clinton. But it was on Monday that several news outlets reported that an investigation by the U.S. Office of Special Counsel said that he had violated the Hatch Act. Now, what is the Hatch Act? This goes back to 1939. It's officially titled An Act to Prevent Pernicious Political Activities for Federal Employees. The main provision prohibits employees in the executive branch of the federal government except for the president, the vice president, and certain designated high-level officials of that branch from engaging in some forms of political activity. Okay? So this is not ethical, and it is corruption, okay? But nothing happens to Julian Castro. It may have hurt his Veep stakes chances here, because the last thing Hillary needs is another reminder of people how they sail past any laws and how the laws don't apply to them. What did he do, however? Okay. They say that he gave an interview and he had the seal of his department, the Housing and Urban Development Department, was visible behind him as he gave the interview. This is reported by the Washington Post, hardly a right wing part of the vast right wing conspiracy, as Hillary Clinton would say. No, this is the Washington Post. He answered questions from host Katie Couric for Yahoo News about his support for Hillary Clinton, including his chances as running mate. Okay. And I say from the report, when Ms. Couric interviewed Secretary Castro, she introduced him as secretary. The official HUD seal appeared behind him. He spent the first 7 minutes talking exclusively about HUD programs and initiatives. And as such, he gave the interview in his official capacity. And they say, although he stated during the interview that he was, quote, taking off my HUD hat for a second and just speaking individually, unquote, to indicate he was answering questions in his personal capacity, that disclaimer could not negate the fact that he was appearing in his official capacity for the rest of the interview. Because he advocated for and against presidential candidates, says the Office of Special Counsel, While appearing in his official capacity, Secretary Castro violated the Hatch Act's prohibition against using one's official authority or influence to interfere with or to affect the result of an election. Okay? So this is something they did. Now, Obama has come out and said there will be no penalty for him. And quite frankly, the penalty for violating the Hatch Act is not that severe. There's no fines. There's no imprisonment. What would happen is you would lose your job. But of course, that's a big deal in Washington. Those are pretty cushy jobs. So I guess that's a pretty rough penalty if you lose that job. But White House Press Secretary Josh Earnest said, well, to his credit, he acknowledges that mistakes were made. Are we going to come after Josh Earnest for plagiarism? How many times have you heard that phrase when people are caught in a crime? Whether they're a politician or whether they're a glitterbug preacher, mistakes were made. Mistakes were made. That is, okay. But of course, plagiarism, I'll remind you, is not a crime, okay? You have to sue somebody if you think that it is something significant, if they copy it and put it in writing and make money off of it, okay? You can sue them for that. But plagiarism is not a crime, as I mentioned, unlike violating intentionally the security regulations as Secretary of State. So when we look at this, even though that is limited to the executive branch, consider what Ruth Bader Ginsburg did about a week and a half ago. Remember, she gave a couple of interviews. One of them she gave with the New York Times, and she said, I can't imagine what this place would be. I can't imagine what the country would be with Donald Trump as our president, she told the New York Times. For the country, it could be 4 years. For the court, it could be, I don't even want to contemplate that. She also had an interview with the AP, where she assumed that Hillary Clinton would be nominated to would win the November election. Asked what would happen in that interview if Trump won, she said, I don't even want to think about the possibility, but if it should be, then everything is up for grabs. So she gave a couple of high-profile interviews, okay? And this is, again, the Washington Post, not part of the vast right-wing conspiracy. And they go out and they talk to law professors and they say, well, you know, she's had a history of being very blunt and outspoken and frank about things, you know, like Scalia used to be. But they said, this is a bit beyond the pale. One guy, who is Arthur Hellman, a law professor at University of Pittsburgh, says, I find it baffling, actually, that she said those things. She must know that she shouldn't. However tempted she might be, she shouldn't be doing this. Another president of Ethics and Public Policy Center, Edward Whelan III, said that this was indefensible. He said, I think this exceeds all the other in terms of her indiscretions. I'm not aware of any justice ever expressing views on the merits or demerits of a presidential candidate in the midst of the campaign. I'm not a fan of Donald Trump's at all, he said. But the soundness or the unsoundness of her concerns about Donald Trump has no bearing on whether it was proper for her to say what she said. And a third one, I'll read you one more. Louis J. Varelli III, a Stetson University law professor, just wrote a book about Supreme Court recusals, right? We just had all these situations with Loretta Lynch refusing to recuse herself, even though she owed her career and had been hired by Bill Clinton, had a lot of economic ties to him, had a lot of political ties to him, had a lot of close family ties to him, but she would not recuse herself from the Clinton review. As a matter of fact, she meets with Bill Clinton privately, although flaunting it in public and in front of people on the plane, okay? Still would not recuse herself. So this guy just wrote a book on recusals. And he said, public comments, like the one that Justice Ginsburg made, could be seen as grounds for her to recuse herself from cases that might involve a future Trump administration. I don't necessarily think she would be required to do that, and I certainly don't believe that she would in every instance, but it could invite challenges to her impartiality based on her public comments, you think? So, you know, we have absolutely, there's look at the amount of coverage that's been given to what Ginsburg did, to what Castro did. Castro violated the Hatch Act. They dropped that bomb during the Republican convention. Nobody talks about it. What were they talking about instead? They were talking about Melania Trump and the fact that she plagiarized some of Michelle Obama's speech, allegedly, okay? And it's now been admitted by somebody today who came out from the Trump campaign and did a mea culpa. Meredith McIver said, I'm the in-house staff writer at the Trump Organization, so forth and so on. You know what? I really could care less. Do you really care? If she took some boilerplate pablum and, you know, platitudes and plagiarized them from somebody else? I mean, Michelle Obama's speech meant nothing, and neither did Melania's. And why does that matter to us when what the Supreme Court justice is doing here is showing us that they're nothing but a bunch of political hacks who can do whatever they wish and openly talk about the fact that they don't even care what the law says. They don't care what the Constitution says. They don't care what the law says. They are judicial activists. They rule in areas in which they have absolutely no authority. They refuse to follow any ethical guidelines, as we see here with Ginsburg. Okay? And we had Donald Trump criticized her for that. He said it was highly inappropriate. He said, I think it's highly inappropriate a U.S. Supreme Court justice, sitting justice, would get involved in a political campaign, frankly, he said. Trump also said, I think it's a disgrace to the court. I think she should apologize to the court. I couldn't believe it when I saw it. She eventually did apologize to the court. He said that she should be saying that. He's so beneath the court for her to be making statements like that. It only energizes my base even more, and I would hope that she would get off the court as soon as possible. Yeah, if she had any integrity, she would resign. She would essentially apply the ethics principles of the Hatch Act, which, although that applies specifically to the executive branch and not to the Supreme Court, because they can do anything they want. See? That's one of the key things we need to understand. You're going to hear Ted Cruz tonight talking so much about Supreme Court justices and how important it is for us to get conservative Supreme Court justices. We need to rethink the scope of the Supreme Court. We need to rethink the authority that they gave themselves with Marbury versus Madison, saying we will have the final say on all things about the Constitution. And now they've gone into becoming judicial activists because they like gay marriage, even though the federal government and the Supreme Court has nothing in the Constitution that says that they have any authority to define marriage one way or the other. They say, well, we're going to say that it's make a federal case out of it, and we're going to rule the way we want to, because they view the Constitution as a living document. They don't care how it was written. They don't care what it meant. They're not there to be legal referees. They are nine political appointees appointed for life. And, you know, we haven't had a very good track record on the conservative side. We have gotten reliable liberal status from the people who have been appointed by the Democrats, but it's been a real mixed bag from Ronald Reagan and everybody else in terms of conservative judges. But I just want to add one more thing to this, and that is, think about the back and forth, the hue and cry, and the outrage when Donald Trump said that he thought a district judge who was reviewing a court case of his had a conflict of interest because this judge is a La Raza lawyer. Takes us right back to the Castros again, doesn't it? This guy is a La Raza lawyer. He is part of a racist Hispanic organization that is there to promote a specific group, not help lawyers in general, but only Hispanic lawyers, to say that, you know, for the race, everything, outside of the race, nothing. How racist can you get? You can't get any more racist than the race, La Raza. And here you have this judge who doesn't just have a Mexican heritage, okay? It's not just his Mexican heritage. It's the fact, and that's really, I think, where Donald Trump lost it there. He wasn't specific enough. You know, he just talked in general terms of his Mexican heritage. His Mexican heritage means everything to this guy, to the point that he's gone off the rails to becoming a racist. And yet, we've fought about that, heard about that for weeks. Yet, you can have ethical violations from a sitting Supreme Court justice. You can have Hatch Act violations from one of the twin sons of one of the founders of La Raza. Nobody pays any attention to it. What an amazing, amazing double standard. Meanwhile, one more piece of Hillary Clinton news here. She's said to be looking as a look forward to who she's going to pick, and she has said that she'll be announcing who she's going to be picking for vice president this Friday. The Democrat convention begins next Monday InfoWars will be there. I'll be there at the Democrat convention. They say that she is seeking national security experience for vice presidential pick. That's not a joke headline, folks. That's for real. Yes, she does need some help for national security. First of all, she needs to understand that it's important. But this is, I guess, part of her narrative to say, you know, I just really didn't know. You know, when you say server, do you mean when you say wiping my server? You mean like with a cloth or something? I'm just a little grandmother, you know. I wear these Chairman Mao suits. Just call me Grandma. I don't really know anything about servers and private networks and all this stuff. So maybe I'll look at somebody who's a 4-star Navy admiral who can help me with that. Also, Tim Kaine, a former Virginia governor, who is now a senator, is there. They're talking about still Elizabeth Warren. Someone else mentions Tim Kaine. He is the one that seems to come up. His name seems to come up in every one of these discussions. Meanwhile, there's a lot of top Democrat Senate hopefuls, people who are in a tough election. They're going to be skipping the convention with Hillary Clinton. You don't hear them talking about that much, do you, either? Okay, stay with us. We're going to be right back. We're going to talk about what's up tonight. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. In this last segment, I want to remind you real quickly before we go back to news. Today is the last day for our 25% off DNA Force. It's selling out very quickly. We have to keep some in reserve for people who are on auto ship. This is our premier product in terms of price because of difficulty of this rare ingredient, BioPQQ. Again, as I mentioned, there's 175 clinical studies. It's extremely hard to secure, very expensive to produce. A 25% discount off of this is a significant savings, but we're going to have to end that tonight. That's 25% off DNA Force. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. All right, there was news today on the Hill. Libertarian nominee suggests that Jeb Bush may back him. This is Gary Johnson saying that he told CNN he'd had conversations with Bush, noting that he did not initiate these conversations, that Jeb had come to him. And I'm looking at this and thinking, what possibly could Jeb have to offer? Maybe he's going to change his slogan to Gary exclamation mark. Oh, no, that wouldn't work, would it? Maybe he can get him hundreds of millions of dollars from Wall Street backers, from globalists who have pursued open trade treaties that have destroyed our economy and our sovereignty. Maybe that would work for him. Well, that didn't work for Jeb either, did it? Okay. Let me tell you something. He's just a guy who has sold out libertarian principles. He is nothing but a political whore. When I look at this, the Libertarian Party has just become another player for big business, globalist, multinational corporations. They don't even support the principles of private property in the Second Amendment anymore. They sold out on that, these two guys, these two former governors that are there. And then tonight we've got Ted Cruz. And as AP points out, no sign of a Trump endorsement, but plenty of Cruz ambition will be on display tonight when Ted Cruz gives his speech. He's not going to explicitly endorse Donald Trump. He is looking towards 2020. But I don't think he can see that far. I think Ted Cruz has got kind of foggy vision. It's not 2020, folks. If you think for a minute, Cruz people, Ted Cruz especially, that by putting Hillary Clinton in, you're going to get a shot in just 4 years, you should have another thing coming. I don't think you can see that clearly because Hillary Clinton, the kind of person she is so incredibly corrupt. She's going to consolidate power to such a degree that you'll never get her out of midterm. It's going to be at least 8 years of Hillary Clinton and then a hand-picked successor after that. You know, it's when we look at what's going on, I got to say that Trump is amazingly and maybe foolishly magnanimous in allowing this ambitious troll to speak tonight. I guess he didn't want to look as bad as the GOP establishment did when Romney shut down Ron Paul, went to a great deal of trouble to do that in the Rules Committee to shut him down. But it's not going to be appreciated by these people, by these never-Trumpers. You know, we watched the histrionics and the temper tantrums that were being done on the floor. I reached out many times to all of these people at the head of the Never Trump movement. They would not return calls, conversations. They don't want to have a conversation about this, except to go on to MSNBC, where they will be welcomed as an opponent of Donald Trump. They don't want to talk about the fact they wanted to steal the votes of the people who voted in the elections. I mean, this is nothing but racketeering and fraud, folks. And it was amazing irony to me that these people would whine and complain because they weren't able to twist and change the rules at this convention like they did at the state conventions. You know, the Never Trumpers really need to go back to their Never Never Land because they won't grow up just like Peter Pan. All right, we're going to be covering more of the Republican National Convention tonight. Our InfoWars Nightly News will be at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern tonight. Join us then. We'll be the, it'll be Ja'Kari Jackson will be hosting tonight. Join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern for the InfoWars Nightly News.